97.5, The Fan.
WIBC HD2, W298BB, WIBC HD3, W228CX, Indianapolis.
It's Kevin and Querry.
I throw, you catch. It's not that hard, okay? All right, get the out of here.
I'm going to talk a lot about drills and fundamentals.
Watch it.
On 93.5.
Watch it.
And 107.5.
Boom, baby.
The Fan.
Kevin, it is a Friday, and that's right there. Outstanding news for everybody. The sun is splashing already. That is great news for everybody. And then I thought about the fact that there are two bits of news that I thought this has got to be a complete emotional juxtaposition for Kevin Bowen. Are you ready?
Okay. I was going to throw in 3-day weekend as well.
Ooh, I forgot about the fact it's a 3-day weekend. And for you, it's like a 10-day weekend, right?
Mm-hmm.
The golden hue coming through the window here is spectacular. And I thought about it, and I thought, you know what? I guess we'll start with a yin and yang for you. Jalen Smith is not yet signed by anybody, but Malcolm Brogdon is still a Pacer.
Yeah, boy, talk about conflicting emotions on the drive in this morning. I'm taking an optimistic point of view to this, Jake, and I look at it and think to myself, the Pacers are going to be the third team involved in a Kevin Durant trade, and they're going to benefit from this. That is my stance on the Pacers free agency. Someone texted me yesterday and go, is Chris Ballard running the Pacers? Does Kevin Pritchard not believe in the first day of free agency either? To be fair, I think, Jake, largely the NBA is on hold until we see something happen in the Kevin Durant news. Obviously, a lot to get to on the NBA front. Ronald Nored, Pacers summer league coach, he is going to join us. Obviously, former Butler player as well on both of those national runner-up teams. He's going to join us at 8:30 today. And Jake, it is July 1, and July 1 in the sports world, oftentimes in this market without a baseball team, is deader than dead. And one thing that is not dead is the pockets of Big Ten universities.
So here's the deal with this, and this has been brewing for so long. If you were shocked by this, and I don't mean this condescendingly, but if you were shocked by this news yesterday, then you haven't really been paying attention. And I don't mean the schools per se, but the thought that eventually probably what we're going to end up with are two major conferences, one of which is going to be a hybrid of the Big and Pac-10 merger, the other of which is going to be either the SEC and ACC combining or the SEC picking and choosing the remainder of big programs that are still out there. For example, Kansas would be one. If you're Kansas, you're like, wait a minute, because the Big 12's kind of been the one left out of the, like, the Big 12 in this party, if this was a movie, the Big 12 is Jonah Hill. Like the awkward kid that, like, it's everybody's kind of laughing at because he can't find his way into the party, right? That, like, if you're the Big 12, you're saying, wait a minute. I mean, the SEC and ACC seem to kind of have maybe something going on here. Same with the Pac-12 and the Big 10. So, you know, where do you go? Excuse me. That's going to be the big question mark moving forward. But I had heard, it's not like I had heard rumblings that UCLA and USC were going to be the first two dominoes to fall. That was definitely of surprise. But when I heard it, my first thought was, wait a minute. If you are a player, if you're a recruit and you're looking at going to UCLA, you're a native of Thousand Oaks, California, you're a quarterback, you're going to go play for UCLA. And you're all excited to play for UCLA, but then you're like, wait a minute, now for my conference games, I'm going to be practicing all week in LA, and then every game, if it's an away game, I'm on a 4-hour flight to West Lafayette, Indiana in November.
Piscataway, baby.
Yeah, New Jersey in November. State College, Pennsylvania in late October. You know, does that, now all of a sudden do I have pause? And so I thought, I wonder how that's going to affect UCLA and USC's recruiting. And then I kind of got more information in talking to people that, you know, hey, listen, big game plan is beyond just this for the Pac-10, because in the next dominoes that I'd heard and I've read now, because I've read a fair amount about it, nothing is guaranteed, Kevin, of course, but Washington, Oregon, Arizona, and Arizona State would be the next dominoes to fall. Then what you get is a realignment where you would have, you know, maybe Nebraska and say like Minnesota go Pac, or, you know, Big Ten West, however they divide it up, right? I mean, the Big Pac Conference and the, you know, Big 12 side, you know, whatever, however they want to call it. But if this merger were to happen, you would still have UCLA and USC. For right now, what it looks like is UCLA and USC's conference foes, the closest one is going to be Nebraska geographically. In reality, I think by the time it's all said and done in 2024, they're still going to be staying west of the Rockies for most of their games until it comes time for like conference tournaments and that kind of thing. Now, the one underlying thing about this that is unfortunate, I don't know how many there are left, but the Big Ten basketball tournaments at Gainbridge Fieldhouse and the Big Ten football championship at Lucas Oil Stadium, probably ought to enjoy those while they last.
Will Indiana or Purdue make a Big Ten football championship in my lifetime?
It's going to be real challenging now, probably, right? Yeah. But they will play in the Rose Bowl, maybe.
The three programs that I thought about immediately yesterday after this news, two are our teams, Notre Dame and Clemson, and the other was Oregon. Because Oregon is a national brand, it has Nike, and you would think they would be highly coveted for those reasons. The ACC part of it, I think, is really interesting. And do you know anything about this grant of rights with the ACC?
No.
So basically, from what I understand, and we're going to have Aaron Torres on at 9 o'clock to talk a little bit more. He's from Fox Sports Radio and an avid college football analyst. He is going to join us. But basically, the ACC has signed a TV rights deal, and their universities have signed it through 2036. And if you look at this conference realignment that we've had just over the last couple of years, Texas, Oklahoma, obviously what you saw yesterday, Jake, the ACC hasn't been involved in any of it. And basically my understanding is if Clemson or Miami or Florida State wants to break away from the ACC, it's going to cost them hundreds of millions of dollars to do that. So that means, and I'm sure we'll get some lawyers involved and there'll be some legal process through all of this, but to me, Clemson, Miami, Florida State, in some order, would be very highly coveted by the Big Ten, the SEC right now, but yet, due to this grant of rights, they can't move for another 13 years, 14 years. And again, we'll see how that all plays out. But I think that is kind of something to watch here. Obviously, Notre Dame.
What if the ACC doesn't exist?
But no one's breaking away from the ACC because they're all in this grant of rights deal with ESPN. Right. For Notre Dame, as long as they have a seat at the college football playoff table.
Do they?
As of right now, they do.
What
does the college football playoff look like in the next 5-6 years? Are we done with automatic qualifiers? You know, I think that's a question you have to ask as well. And of course, Oregon, what do you see happen there? Does the Big 12 look at this and say, all right, from a geographic standpoint, let's try and get the remaining Pac-12 teams, try and create some semblance of regionality to our conference, which the Big 12, if you look at it on a map, it's incredibly spread out to begin with. Those are some of the questions that I have about, you know, Oregon, Notre Dame, and the ACC schools.
This is going to come down to the following. This kind of is like LIV Golf and the PGA. A split, if you will, where there's like definitive party lines. But I could see it coming down to this, to make it simple. I have long felt that we were headed towards, and I think with the name, image, likeness, it is possible. But I have long felt, and I've said on radio shows for a long time, that I felt like eventually we were going to have super conferences that break away and secede from the NCAA because they're going to say, look, we've got name, image, likeness now. We are semi-pro ball. We're paying players.
Shouldn't football just break away?
That's what it feels like, right?
Like, why is a men's soccer match with 30 men and women getting on an airplane on a Tuesday night to go travel from, again, Piscataway to Los Angeles?
That's the crazy part. And here's the thing.
The Olympic sport impact, I think, is beyond idiotic.
I get, okay, there are a lot of layers to this onion, so let's begin with this first, to your point. The lesser revenue sports, soccer, track and field, volleyball. I travel a lot for IndyCar on weekends, and I every time I fly, I'm not unique, anybody can relate to this, the number of times that you're in O'Hare or in the Dallas airport, and here comes a pack of college kids wearing matching sweatsuits and backpacks, and you're like, oh, look.
There's the softball team.
There's the Eastern Michigan track and field team on their way to somewhere. Most of these teams are flying commercial. They're not flying charter. You know, the football and basketball teams are flying private planes, chartered planes. The rest of them are flying commercial. It's a logistical challenge, to say the least. The money that's going to come in to these schools will assist with that to some extent, but it's not going to change the dynamic of, if you are a rower at UCLA, having a Thursday meet or match or whatever you call it in Rutgers, and then going back and going home because you've got Arizona coming on Saturday. I mean, you know,
they should just meet at the Mississippi River.
That's exactly right.
And have their crew. That's exactly crew match.
Exactly right.
There, yeah. So you guys in Jefferson City, Missouri, or something.
You know what they could do is one of those like algebra equations where they just start rowing in L.A. and then rowing in Rutgers, and the first one to meet at Nebraska wins.
Yep. Big Ten champ. There you go.
But at any rate, that's one layer to this onion. But I truly believe it is possible that what you will have is a Pac-10, Big Ten merger. Okay, so we'll call that for lack of a better phrase, we're just going to call that the Pac Big, the Big Pack. That's what it's going to be, the Big Pack, right? Then you have, let's say, an SEC and ACC merger, and the ACC with the rights thing you're talking about. They're allowed to do this because they're not breaking away from one another. Let's just say, for the sake of legal mumbo jumbo. So that one is, we're going to call that the Southeast Atlantic. So those are the two big super conferences, the Southeast Atlantic and the Big Pack. Then you have the leftovers, which are the Big 12, and then the occasional, you know, schools that, where is Connecticut now? What league are they in?
Big East, right? Didn't they just realign to the Big East?
Okay, so Connecticut has football and basketball.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah, I was thinking basketball.
So you've got this leftover league, right? That's like your independents, like Notre Dame and Army and Navy.
Yeah, the Houstons of the world.
The Houstons, yeah. So they all get together. And that literally is like when you're moving and you've got that one box of stuff. You're like, just throw it all in that and we'll... So that one we're going to call, because that's got the Big 12 in it as well, right? We're just going to call that the Big Others. And so each league is going to nominate each league is going to have their own championship. And the two teams from that, you know, the champion and the runner-up are then going to go to a football playoff, and you have a 16 playoff.
Ooh, the SEC's not signed up for that. Big Ten's not signed up for that. The SEC and Big Ten want as many teams possible at that table.
That's probably true. But right now,
and they're going to look at. I mean, didn't the
but
SEC?
Right now, Kevin, in football, the most that the SEC can get is what, probably two teams, right? In the
right,
football playoff.
But if you expand, I mean, hasn't the SEC? The talk has been, hey, you expand to 12, and we're going to get four
well.
Or five
okay,
teams
so maybe
in.
You do a bigger playoff. But I'm just saying.
I just think football, and I get it, the revenue, the trickle-down effect, it does help out in a massive way, those Olympic sport teams. But it just seems like football has got to break away. Something that I would like to see with college athletics, Jake, right now, is some sort of just CBA. Can we get to a point, and I'm going to throw transfer portal, NIL, all of this under the same umbrella, but can we get to a point where we have 5 to 10 years of calm waters, and these are the rules, and these are the regulations, but for a 5 to 10 year period, I know what teams are going to be in what conferences, how the transfer rules work, how the NIL rules work. I think that is a must for college athletics right now. Because, Jake, if I went up to my dad, who is a casual sports fan, and said, Dad, here's a pen and paper, list the teams in these conferences, he'd probably get 50% of them right. And I think that is a big issue in trying to retain fans and trying to create a semblance of, oh, yeah, there is a little bit of continuity and some sort of normalcy to it all. Because right now, is there a more laughable term in the world than student-athlete?
Yeah, for sure.
It's athlete-student, and athlete is like 72 font, and student is like 12 font with this rule as well. A couple other thoughts, Jake, that I wanted to hit on. And again, we'll certainly get to NBA free agency, the Kevin Durant news. A very quiet opening day, really around the league. I think there are only 9 or 10 deals where guys actually signed with other teams. The Pacers sitting that one out. I still think they can get involved and make something notable happen. Are USC and UCLA good anymore? The last 4 years, Jake, USC, 5-8, 5-4 wins. The last 4 years.
You talking about football?
For UCLA, yep. 3-4, 3-8.
Yeah, there's...
And have you seen the crowds at these games? I mean, it is pathetic, the amount of people showing up to a USC football game. Now, maybe Lincoln Riley is the hero that changes all of it. Or maybe Lincoln Riley says, oh my God, I did not think this. I'm going to the NFL.
I didn't sign up for having to get my guys to go fly to... And again, we don't know, Kevin. I think that we... Here's the thing. Our thought process is like, man, UCLA and USC flying back and forth to Michigan State and Nebraska and Penn State and Maryland. I don't know that that's going to be the case. I think they're still going to be flying to Arizona and Arizona State and Oregon and
so
Washington.
So you see it expanding with the
totally
Pac-12 coastal schools. I think
the two schools that are like kind of the question marks in flux are, like, as of right now, I think the bus is sitting at the bus station, and Colorado and Utah are both on the platform, and the bus is about to shut the doors, and Colorado and Utah are the two that are like, ah, do we go or we stay here?
I mean, isn't it all come down to, basically, TV contracts are deciding where these conferences go, right?
Correct.
Isn't that what happened here?
Correct.
Fox is located in L.A.
Correct.
Fox owns a Big Ten network, and they're saying, you need USC and UCLA.
Correct. That is correct.
It's just a lot. Again, I need some sort of settlement. I need some sort of CBA. There's so much rocky waters with college sports right now. It's impossible to keep track of. And NIL and transfer portal fall into this. Pat Forty, Jake, had a really interesting comment that we'll hit on a little bit later in the 7 o'clock hour. And he used Purdue as an example. And I want to get your thoughts on that in a little bit. Just quick thoughts on the Pacers yesterday.
I think there is one piece of good news. If you are a Pacer optimist, which I realize it might be hard to be for people, I do think that, Kevin, I think that people, this is what makes me kind of laugh about free agency. It's kind of, I've always fallen with it when it comes to free agency under which way do you want it? Because you get Pacer fans that are jumping up and down saying, why haven't they signed anybody? You got to sign somebody. They're just asleep at the wheel. And then on the other hand, they're like, it's absurd. They're still paying Monte Ellis. What a bust. That was a terrible signing. Well, Monte Ellis was a notable signing when they signed him as a free agent.
No longer paying him. Cheers to that on this July 1st.
That's right. So, yeah, he's off the books now. But my point being, he's an example of a guy that, like, you had to sign somebody, right? So they went out and signed Monte Ellis. We might as well get Monte Ellis. This was a dry free agency class, other than guys that were just getting max contracts to stay where they were. Bradley Beal, you know, Nikola Jokic, Karl Anthony Towns. Those guys weren't going anywhere. Ja Morant. So the big splash free agents, you know, who truly are the big splash free agents?
Yeah, Jalen Brunson getting $105, $110 million is just kind of like, is that so Knicks?
Totally. I mean, that's the thing, right? Like, how many teams realistically, is Jalen Brunson really worth $26 million to somebody? The Knicks, obviously. But it's auxiliary pieces that can cement or solidify a group together. That I kind of admittedly, like Bobby Portis. Bobby Portis for 4 years, $49 million, seems like a pretty good deal. That's a really, I thought that would have been a negotiable deal for Indiana. But Bobby Portis takes that to stay in Milwaukee. There was another player that I saw. Oh, the guy that I'd mentioned that I like, Kyle Anderson. 2 years, $18 million to go to Minnesota.
And I saw your guy, P.J. Tucker, 76ers.
3 years, $33 million. That's a little high. That price tag's a little high for that. Kyle Anderson's the kind of player I would have liked to have seen the Pacers make a splash with. But the good news is, Kevin, and this stuns me, Jalen Smith's still unsigned. And you would think that if he was going to get the kind of deal that would have been worth bypassing the one-year offer from Indiana, it would have happened yesterday. If it doesn't happen today, then it's really good news.
Tony East mentioned this on Twitter yesterday, Jake, that the mid-level exception, which kind of falls in that, you know, $7, $8 million range where you would think Jalen Smith would get an offer, a lot of teams are starting to use that. So he feels like yesterday you start to kind of see some teams dry up with resources that could pursue Jalen Smith. One thing to note on Kevin Durant, because I think that news yesterday just put the whole NBA on pause. Of like, hey, we're not doing anything until we see what happens with the Durant domino.
What's the deal with this guy?
Well, I think he's finally realizing that being alongside Kyrie Irving is something you don't want to do.
But now supposedly Kyrie Irving wants to go with him.
You look at Durant, and Phoenix is the rumor right now. DeAndre Ayton, Mikal Bridges, let's say they go to Brooklyn. Durant goes to Phoenix. They need another team to get involved to match up salaries. Boom, here come the Pacers. Here comes Malcolm Brogdon, and the Pacers get Cam Johnson back.
Yeah, I could see them being, you know, kind of like when they were involved in the deal that...
James Harden.
Yeah, I was going to say. They were involved in that Caris LeVert acquisition.
Back to the Kevin Pritchard word, the night of the lottery, optionality. I know it sounds weird and sounds a little juicy or whatever, but he's right. The Pacers are still in a position where they can get involved in some things. Now, I want to see them go ahead and do that, but I am not pressing the panic button just a day into free agency yet. I still think they sit here in a position to look at what happens with Ayton, look at what happens with Durant, and where can they get involved and where can they provide relief for a team and therefore get back kind of a young asset that matters.
The hell? Pacers should go for Kevin Durant. Push all in.
You know, someone tweeted at me yesterday, would the Nets do Malcolm Brogdon, Miles Turner, and a first-round pick for Kevin Durant? I would think you would have to throw in probably Boomer, Power Pack, Flamingo Man.
Two more number ones.
What do you think, naming rights?
Boyle.
Boy, Boyle's coveted. That's a good one. Maybe you to sit second row like you do now. You know,
somebody, I'd do that in Brooklyn. You kidding me?
Jake Query, you know, Michael Grady and him have a...
I've got a Brooklyn hat.
There's zero chance the Pacers would be able to drum up a trade package that Brooklyn would say yes to / Kevin Durant would sign off on. Because I know Durant has 4 years left on his deal, and technically he can't like demand where he goes. But the Brooklyn wants Kevin Durant to be happy because they want the team getting him to send back a package that they deem as, oh, yeah, we're going to keep Kevin Durant for a while, so we're going to get a lot of return on this. And obviously Kevin Durant's track
record. Kevin, we know that you got tired of playing with Kyrie Irving, but you're going to play with Dwayne Washington Jr. next year as your starting backcourt.
Have you seen Terry Taylor's highlights from
enjoy.
Last year? He's Jake Query. I'm Kevin Bowen, Mark Dykton across the way. It is a gorgeous Friday, as Jake said, here in Indianapolis. And we're going to have a loaded guest line. James Boyd from the Star to talk about a quiet day one for the Pacers at 8. Ronald Nored, the head coach of the Pacers Summer League, which begins a week from today in Vegas. He joins us at 8:30. And some college sports chatter with the realignment bombshell from yesterday with Aaron Torres at 9 o'clock. Good Friday morning to you, 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
School is in session.
Seth Greenberg!
Do you like Andrew Nebhard at all?
Yes, I think he's a perfect second unit guy.
Yeah.
He's getting an offense. He's got good size. He's very, very good in ball screens. When you talk to Mark Few, he says the best ball screen guard they've ever had. My brother coached in the Canadian national team. I absolutely loved him as a person. That was coming out of his Florida year. I think that's a really good selection there, a guy that's going to be in the league.
Dan Dockage, weekdays noon to 3 on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
Take Audible along this summer and listen to best-selling audiobooks, exclusive originals, and podcasts. Start with a free 30-day trial at audible.com.
Jake Query here. IndyCar heads to Mid-Ohio this Sunday for the Honda Indy 200. The broadcast this Sunday on The Fan at noon is brought to you by the Indianapolis Speedrome and Circle City Raceway.
It's a granddaddy of a sale.
Call me Window.
Up to 50% off plus manufacturer's rebates and
no interest, no payments for 18 months.
Diamonds Direct right now. There's nothing standing in your way of owning the piece of jewelry you've been dreaming of. No down payment and no finance charges for 5 whole years on any purchase. Take the amazing Diamonds Direct price you're used to, divide by 60, and that's your payment. It's a smart way to buy. Keep your money in your pocket and still add that amazing ring, band, or bracelet to your collection. Even the upgrade you've been wanting. 5 years, zero interest on any purchase. Only at Diamonds Direct. Get all the details at DiamondsDirect.com. On approved credit.
Terry Stacey with your American Standard Race Day weather brought to you by B&W Plumbing, Heating, Cooling, and Drains. Independence Weekend features great road course racing. IndyCar is at Mid-Ohio Sunday at noon, partly sunny and 90 degrees at the green flag. Afterwards, the NASCAR guys are at Road America in Elkhart Lake, Wisconsin, partly sunny and a high of 82. This has been your race day weather brought to you by B&W Plumbing, Heating, Cooling, and Drains, your independent American Standard heating and air conditioning dealer.
O'Reilly. Change your vehicle's oil before your summer road trip and save money now with Pennzoil and O'Reilly Auto Parts. Right now, get 5 quarts of Pennzoil Platinum Full Synthetic for just $22.95 after mail-in rebate. Save money and protect your engine against sludge and wear with the synthetic oil change. Stop by your local O'Reilly Auto Parts today or O'ReillyAuto.com.
O'Reilly Auto Parts.
When you sign up for BP Me Rewards, you can get 5 cents off every gallon of gas every time at BP or Amoco stations. That means more savings and more whatever you'd like to use your savings on. So treat yourself. It's on us. Visit bp.com/rewards to learn more.
Not again, man.
Gone too far looking for a good deal on gas? Try Price Match, only from BP Me Rewards at participating BP and Amoco stations. Learn more at bp.com/bestprice.
Charlie says sell it, so there's huge deals again this week at Payless Liquors. Southern Comfort 50-milliliter variety packs are only $4.69. Ready-to-drink 4-packs of Mom Water are $8.99. Crown Royal RTDs, $12.99. Franzia Box Wine start at only $14.99. And 18-packs of Bud Light and Coors Light are $14.99 for the 12-ounce cans, $19.99 for the 16-ouncers. And be sure to pick up some Evan Williams Black Label. The 1.75-liter bottle is only $22.99 at all 26 family-owned Payless Liquor locations. Don't pay more, get more, and pay less at Payless Liquors.
Indy 11 is celebrating Independence Day Saturday, July 2nd with downtown's only fireworks show that night after their 7:30 match versus Miami FC at Carroll Stadium. Presented by IBEW Local 481, it'll be great family fun with tickets starting at just $15. Come early for live music by Cam Cole from Apple TV's Ted Lasso show. Get $11 meal deals and $4 Heineken. Then stay late for a fireworks show synced to a soundtrack curated by JMV's Takeover program on B105.7. Get tickets and details at Indy11.com.
Hey, JMV, sometimes, too many times, bad things happen to good people. Good people get hurt or killed through no fault of their own. That's where Tony Patterson at Parr Ritchie Law Firm can help. Tony understands because he spent his career helping people just like you put their lives back together. He was honored by Best Lawyers as 2020's Indianapolis Personal Injury Lawyer of the Year. See if Tony can help you. The call is free, 317-269-2509, or visit parrinjury.com, parrinjury.com today.
The Morning Checkdown.
Omaha! Omaha! Omaha!
to you by QC Kinetics, relieving your joint pain at QCKinetics.com on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
All right, Mark, let's get out of the way. Go ahead. Go ahead. Play your highlights, whatever you're going to do here. 23 hits. Cubs beat the Reds 15-7.
Oh, I actually didn't prepare for that today. I'm sorry.
Excuse me?
Should I believe him, Jake?
That's drilled out towards left center field. That one back. He's done it again. Second homer of the night, Patrick Wisdom. And he's knocked in six. Mm-hmm. And it is all Cubs. Get up.
All right, Mark. A little longer clip than I was hoping for there.
Well, there's longer ones coming.
Cubs beat the Reds 2-1 in that series there. 15-7. Again, 23 hits. The Reds stink. Just absolutely stink. Guardians 5-3 over the Twins. Walk off there. Kind of a quiet day in baseball outside of that.
Yeah, it was pretty enjoyable for me, I'd say.
Indianapolis Indians got a 4-3 win over Nashville. Did you mention that?
I did not know.
Big news yesterday in college athletics, as we talked about it, and Will, over the course of the day. UCLA and USC jumping ship. Obviously not immediately, but by 2024. They'll be members of the Big Ten. We shall see if others, notably Arizona, Arizona State, Oregon, and Washington, follow suit. Yes, there is a like an academic standard that the Big Ten...
Yeah, research institutions or...
Yeah, but Nebraska does not qualify for that, apparently. So there are...
They don't research corn?
Exceptions. Nebraska and education don't really go hand in hand.
Excuse me?
What?
You could make the argument football and Nebraska don't go hand in hand either.
Mark, what do you have against Nebraska? Nothing. What's the morning show in Lincoln? Do we know?
I don't know. I can only imagine they're talking about
Mark with just a jab in Nebraska.
I know. What do you got against Nebraska?
I don't know. Nothing. I've never been there.
Jake, you've got Mid-Ohio.
Keep your pie hole shut.
You've got Mid-Ohio this weekend. 12 o'clock, our coverage begins there. For those that have never been, a little rundown on what we will see on Sunday.
Mid-Ohio is a cool track because it is, you know, there's some elevation changes to it. It's a historic sports car track. It is one that does have good passing opportunities, but Scott Dixon has been dominant there over the course of his career. I think 6 wins, maybe 7. And it typically is the track where Dixon kind of gets things going in terms of turning his seasons around. But again, like most IndyCar weekends, probably a legitimate shot for, you know, 6 to 8 different drivers to be able to have themselves a dominant weekend. So after a couple of weeks off, it'll be good to get back out on the racetrack.
Again, our coverage 7 o'clock there, Mid-Ohio. The last 5 champions there have been different. Dixon has had a great run there, but Rossi, Dixon, Will Power, Colton Herta, Joseph Newgarden lead into this year.
NBA free agency Ja Morant, big time payday, no surprise there. He is going to agree to a 4-year, $226 million extension with the Memphis Grizzlies. Also staying put with their teams with extensions, the MVP of the league, Nikola Jokic, as well as Karl Anthony Towns, the Nuggets and the Timberwolves, respectively, for those two. Notable free agents yesterday, again, not a huge class. Gary Payton II signing with Portland. We had talked about a couple of guys that maybe the Pacers, just in terms of their style of play, might have taken a look at. Kyle Anderson signing a 2-year, $18 million deal in Minnesota. Nicholas Batum staying with the Clippers for 2 years. Your guy, Chris, how do you say his last name in Toronto?
Boucher.
Bobby Boucher, right?
A healthy deal, right, to stay in Toronto?
3-year, $32.5 million with Toronto. And Gary Harris, the former Hamilton Southeastern star and Indiana Mr. Basketball, 2 years, $26 million to stay with the Magic.
Did you see who else Toronto signed? An outside of the building free agent there, former Pacer.
Really?
Thaddeus Young.
Good for him.
2 years, $16 million for the 34-year-old Thaddeus Young. Did you mention Gary Harris?
I did.
2 for $26 million. I thought that was big.
That actually is a decent number for him, although he made $21 million last year.
Victor Oladipo, 1 for $11 million at the age of 30 years old. So after the league minimum for Victor.
He's got to take a gamble for another year, right?
Yeah, he gets a nice deal. And unfortunate news for Jaren Jackson Jr. Announced yesterday a stress fracture in his right foot. He is out 4 to 6 months. So a former Park Tudor Panther there. You hate to see that for anybody, Jake. You hate to see it for big guys.
Yeah, and
especially that young.
He's a good player, no doubt. Really good player.
And obviously a big part of what Memphis is building down there. Ronald Nored going to join us in about an hour. We'll ask him about some of the draft prospects for the Pacers as they get ready. I found it a little interesting. Chris Duarte is going to play in Summer League. Does that usually happen?
That's surprising.
Him and Isaiah Jackson on the roster.
Yeah, I mean, second year guy, I guess I could see it, right?
Yeah, I mean, I'm a fan of it, you know, more experience for those guys. But they will be on the Summer League roster as well as this year's draft class, a couple undrafted free agents. So we'll talk with Nored about that. We come back, we'll get more into this USC-UCLA thing. As I was mentioning earlier, Pat Forty from Yahoo Sports, longtime cover of college athletics, he had an interesting note yesterday on Purdue and maybe just some other Big Ten teams and the impact on them. We'll touch on that next here. Kevin Aquari on a beautiful Friday morning.
Join me today. Jason Benetti is going to join. We're going to talk, I don't know, whatever Benetti wants to talk about, something to do. I'm going to get you set up for the 4th of July weekend or what a weekend it's going to be. Join me today.
Hey, JMV for Indiana's Best, Andy Moore, Buick GMC, that's 131st and State Road 37 in Fishers. Into 2022, we go with a load of inventory. Your selection is enhanced, your car buying experience, the absolute best. Talk to my good friend Eric Wilson if you're looking for a new set of wheels in the new year. Get it done at only one place. That's Andy Moore Buick GMC. Tell him I sent you. 131st and State Road 37. It's Andy Moore Buick GMC in Fishers.
Hey, tennis fans. With the BetRivers.com Sportsbook app, you can smash, slice, and spin your way to big tennis paydays. That's because we're serving up the excitement of live in-game betting where you can bet on all the action, including point-by-point betting from tournaments around the world. Plus, with BetRivers' award-winning customer service, it's game, set, and match. Download the BetRivers.com Sportsbook app. It's a whole new game.
Must be 21. Must be located in Indiana. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-9-WITH-IT. 1-800-994-8448.
Hey, JMV, if you have a water softener in your home, you probably forgot to add salt a couple of times. And without salt in your softener, that can really wreck your home appliances. That's why my friends at Kinetico created the new Kinex Salt Monitor. It sends alerts to your smartphone when you're running low on salt, and you can check salt levels anywhere, anytime. For a limited time, Kinetico is slashing the price of the Kinex Salt Monitor in half. Act fast and take advantage of this great deal on the Kinex Salt Monitor. Get all the details, KineticoIndy.com today.
Denny Smith here for Sundown Gardens. The 4th of July sale at Sundown Gardens runs from June 25th through July 3rd. Container shrubs and perennials are 20% off, and get this, all items in Miss Mary's gift shop are 30% off. The 4th of July sale at Sundown Gardens, June 25th through July 3rd. Sundown Gardens will be closed on July 4th to celebrate Independence Day. Sundown Gardens at 186th Street and Spring Mill Road. Follow them on Facebook and Instagram, sundowngardens.com. That's sundowngardens.com.
Dear driver, thank you. Thank you for slowing down when you saw the orange cones and road construction signs. My husband is one of those road workers. And today, you saved his life. If you hadn't slowed down, you would have missed that lane change, driven right into the work zone, and you would have killed him. Because you were driving differently. He'll be at our son's Little League game this weekend. He'll be there to walk our daughter down the aisle. He'll be out there tomorrow, making Indiana's roads safer. Thank you.
When driving in a construction zone, be smart, be alert, be in the zone.
This is Joe Bulk, business manager of Labor's Local 204. Everyone deserves a safe place to work. Do your part in the cone zone. Slow down, save a life. We're all in this together.
A message from Indiana's District Council of Laborers International Union of North America and affiliated locals.
As a Shane Company jewelry consultant, I see so many customers who have struggled to find a wedding band at other stores. When they come to Shane Company, they find the one. Not only do we have the widest selection of unique wedding bands, we are also experts at helping you find the perfect band to complement your engagement ring, even if it's an heirloom ring. You can play around with stacking bands, try contour bands, or just go with something simple. There are so many options. We also have handsome men's bands, hundreds of styles to choose from in every price range. You might have no idea what you want, but we'll take the time to show you different metal types, fits, and styles. You can even build your own with our online tool. And we offer a free lifetime warranty. Come see us and we'll help you both find a band that you love wearing every day. For some helpful tips, check out our online wedding band guide.
Now you have a friend in the jewelry business, Shane Company and ShaneCo.com.
This is Matt Crowder live at the gas station on 41st Street reporting on those skyrocketing gas prices. Excuse me, miss. Are you buying less gas now because of the high prices?
Oh, I never pay full price for gas anymore. I just use the free Upside app that pays you cash back for every gallon of gas you buy.
Wait a minute. Are you saying you actually get paid cash when you buy gas with the Upside app?
Yes, I get real cash back every time I buy gas.
Well, does that actually add up to anything?
I've made around $200.
Wow. Well, there you have it. Stop paying full price for gas. Download the free Upside app and get real cash back every time you buy gas. This is Matt Crowder Radio News Network. Download the free Upside app now to earn real cash back every time you buy gas. Use promo code BUS for a $5 bonus on your first tank. You can cash out anytime right to your bank, to PayPal, or any gift card for Amazon and other brands. Just download the free Upside app and use promo code BUS for a $5 bonus on your first tank. That's code BUS.
Indy 11 is celebrating Independence Day Saturday, July 2nd with Downtown's only fireworks show that night after their 7:30 match versus Miami FC at Carroll Stadium. Presented by IBEW Local 481. It'll be great family fun with tickets starting at just $15. Come early for live music by Cam Cole from Apple TV's Ted Lasso show. Get $11 meal deals and $4 Heineken. Then stay late for a fireworks show synced to a soundtrack curated by JMV's Takeover program on B105.7. Get tickets and details at Indy11.com.
Join Mark Patrick Seminars and stop smoking now without cravings, irritability, weight gain, or your money back. Only $49.99 guaranteed. Also, let Mark Patrick Hypnosis destroy unwanted food cravings and lose the weight. Seminars Thursday, July 28th at the Hampton Inn and Suites in Fishers. Weight loss seminar 5:30 to 7:30 p.m. Stop smoking seminar 8 to 10 p.m. And Saturday, July 30th at the La Quinta Inn and Suites South in Indianapolis. Weight loss seminar 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Stop smoking seminar 2 to 4 p.m. Registration begins 30 minutes before seminar.
You are listening to Kevin and Query on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
It was that song that led off the Zoom for the Big Ten presidents last night as they welcomed USC and UCLA into the conference, and that means a whole lot and TV revenue coming the way of the respective Big Ten programs, universities here, once that new TV deal becomes official. Jake, one thing I wanted to mention before we got back into that conversation, during the break, I walked up to the TV to take a closer look at what's happening in Wimbledon, and Mark got nervous. He was like, oh, wow, are you betting on Wimbledon? Which I'm thinking to myself, God, what does that say about me that Mark just assumes that immediately there's a degenerate thought.
I hadn't seen you get up to watch Wimbledon, and all of a sudden you're like staring like twice at the time. I was like, what's going on,
Mark,
here?
You're the degenerate gambler of the group. We know that.
Okay.
You guys have heard me say this before. I have some investment into sports where Americans tend to struggle and or are the underdog. I kind of find it fascinating. Men's tennis would certainly be that. 32 men left in Wimbledon. 8 are Americans. That is the most since when? So 8 of the final 32 men from America. Last time they had that number. Or at least that number, I should say.
1987.
I was going to say, okay, I'll go a little bit later because I'm going to go 92.
97.
Well, that would have been Sampras probably. Would that have been too early for Roddick?
I assume, was Agassi still playing then?
Agassi. I forgot about Agassi. Image is everything, baby.
Yeah, Roddick won in 03. That's the last Grand Slam title win. Got to the final in, I think, 08, 09. But yeah, I'm watching Francis Tiafoe, American. Big second set save there, Jake, in case you're wondering. So I'll keep you posted on that.
Where's Francis from?
I actually just
looked Jupiter, Florida. Mark?
Right time zone. I'll give you that.
Mobile, Alabama.
It was Mobile on Central.
What's your Alabama fascination this week,
Mark? I don't know.
What would they be saying?
Hey, Ashley, we're taking a trip down to Birmingham.
If he's from Mobile, Alabama, what are the locals saying about him on talk radio this morning?
Now, I know y'all looking forward to us breaking down this 2004 Crimson Tide spring game play-by-play for the next 4 hours. We're going to take a quick break and talk Wimbledon, if you don't mind.
Francis's backhand is what we're going to come back with. Hyattsville, Maryland.
Really? Okay. Fair enough.
Hyattsville, Maryland.
Jake, I found this interesting, and it sounds pretty juicy to me, but at this point, I almost feel like anything could appear on the table with conference realignment, and it shouldn't totally shock us. I'm going to read you this excerpt from Pat Forty, who, again, extremely plugged into college athletics, based out of Louisville. He wrote this yesterday. As we trend toward the survival of the richest and fittest, how secure should the less marketable and successful schools feel within the Big Ten and the SEC? If everything is negotiable and every agreement is breakable, is the Big Ten really committed to keeping Purdue and Minnesota for the long term? What about Vanderbilt, the Mississippi schools in the SEC? Watch your backs, Boilermakers, Gophers, Commodores, Rebels, and Bulldogs.
It's a good question. I think one would think that if the Big Ten is driving this bus originally, and this is partially motivated by the Big Ten Network, that the, I'm going to say for lack of a better phrase, when I say the original Big Ten schools, I don't mean like University of Chicago. I mean the existing Big Ten schools, you would think would be safe, right? Or is that totally naive of me?
I think to the point you just made, Jake, who is making this call? I said in the opening segment, Fox Sports is telling the Big Ten, look at how much money you can make by welcoming in this school. That, to me, is the driving force behind all of this. Now, yes, university presidents ultimately are voting on this, but if you're sitting in there and you're, whatever, Michigan State's president, and you're thinking, you know, Minnesota or Oregon, who's going to bring more to our conference? And you look at the dollar amount, if that's the only thing that matters to you, then I don't know. This idea doesn't seem as the most far-fetched thing in the world. Like, how much does Big Ten history matter? How much does a TV market that whatever Purdue pulls in matters versus, hey, we can go out and get Oregon, or we can try and get Clemson, or we can get a Notre Dame, something along those lines. And maybe the Big Ten will just grow and not want to lose any team, so maybe they'll just continue to add numbers. But if it gets into a subtraction addition, could we see some of these teams that are longtime Big Ten programs but yet aren't in major media markets, aren't at the top or near the top of college football, whatever, college basketball, whatever you want to throw in there, and now all of a sudden they're left to fend for themselves?
Yeah, I mean, I think, listen, Notre Dame is one, Kevin, that is of interest to me because let me put it to you this way, and I will admit to having a bias against Notre Dame. I will readily admit it. I'm not a Notre Dame fan, right? I respect Notre Dame's place, and I certainly know of Notre Dame's clout. But I feel like there's an arrogance with Notre Dame that forever Notre Dame's like, we don't need to be in a conference. We just don't. And I know that they're kind of linked to the ACC now, but like, did Notre Dame miss their window when seemingly they've been given the overture on numerous occasions to join the Big Ten and they just refuse to do so? Are these leagues going to say to Notre Dame, like, hey, you know what? You had your shot, man.
I don't think we're going to get to that point, Jake, and I couldn't agree more. Yes, there is an arrogance about Notre Dame. I'm not going to act like Notre Dame is not sitting there, you know, stroking their ego. But at the same time, the Big Ten, the SEC, I think would welcome Notre Dame in an instant. I don't think we're to the point where, nope, you've burned bridges or you've told me no. Notre Dame is the lingering ex-boyfriend, ex-girlfriend that gets a whole lot of opportunity. Look what they did for the ACC a couple years ago during COVID, Jake, when they brought up that TV revenue, went into that conference, obviously won the conference that year, or I should say got to the playoff that year, and brought a whole lot of TV revenue there. But I think this is, of all the things that have happened, Notre Dame conference realignment over the past few years, Jake, I think this is the one that could potentially get them to finally fully join. Because, you know, USC and Notre Dame have had a strong partnership. And now all of a sudden, okay, what does a non-conference schedule look like for USC? How does Notre Dame tap into the LA market? You know, one of the great things as a Notre Dame fan, and I think what Notre Dame loves, is their schedule has a very coastal feel to it. You know, they can get into the New York market, they can get into the LA market with how they schedule where they play games. Well, now if you look at the Big Ten, you just join the conference and you're going to be in
right.
all these big markets. And like you said, from an ACC standpoint right now, their Olympic sports, that's where they all play. How would you rank that? Notre Dame, Clemson, Oregon. How would you rank those three teams as right now the most coveted singles, if you will? The three out there that don't have a date to prom. In what order would you rank those three? And I guess, would you put anybody else in that group?
Okay. Notre Dame's one by a long shot. Oregon's two, and not as far behind Notre Dame as people think because of the Nike money and just Oregon's got a brand.
I think Oregon has a big-time national brand.
I'll put it to you this way, Mark.
Yes.
And I'm for those that are unfamiliar with the program, you, unfortunately, your parents were involved in an auto accident. Fortunately, mm-hmm. they're okay.
Yep.
Where you had to go out to Eugene, Oregon.
Mm-hmm.
You and your dad... What's the one thing that you kind of had to do when you were in Eugene?
It's not even that I wanted to do it. He said, don't you like Oregon? I was like, yeah, I randomly like Oregon football. I don't know why. I just do. But he's like, well, why don't we stop by and get lunch? So I was like, well, we don't have to. He's like, no, stop by and see it. When else are you going
to
be out here?
And you had to go to the bookstore and get a t-shirt, right?
Yep.
Now, would that have been the case if the same thing had happened to your parents?
In Corvallis.
Correct. Right.
No, probably not.
So it's a national brand that mm-hmm. has appeal and sexiness to it.
Yes.
You didn't want a Beaver Fever shirt?
I would have worn that.
Bucky Nuggets knockoff.
I went to an Oregon State game. My buddy Kai Steffi and I were in Portland for the IndyCar race, decided to go, and we watched Oregon State and Oklahoma State, and we're all in. Kai and I are all in on Oregon State.
Now, University of Oregon, they're using that Nike money because that bookstore is nice.
Oh, sure.
It's very nice.
Now, so Oregon is second, third, and way down behind is Clemson.
Ahead of Miami, Florida State?
No. I would put, at this point, I would put Florida, both ahead of Clemson. Because
really?
Because I think that both of them have a football cachet. Both of them have a basketball cachet to an extent. And clearly Miami has financial backing. It's a very elite academic institution. Florida State is a huge brand nationally. Clemson is a dynamic football program, but it's a football program that also is probably kind of on the backslide.
You are down on the Tigers.
No, I love them, and I think they're still really good. But in terms of being in that sphere, that stratosphere they were in, I think they're down a notch. I mean, I think they went from being... I think Clemson has gone from being the New England Patriots to being the Tennessee Titans in terms of their, 10-year run.
Should we be worried about March Madness?
Yes. Absolutely. I mean, this is all a football-driven move.
Yeah, without a doubt.
But it's going to have impact on college basketball for
sure. No one in the room is saying, what about St. Peter's?
Right.
Hell, no one in the room is saying, what about Gonzaga?
Right.
You know, I mean, can you imagine if there was a Gonzaga equivalent of college football?
Does Gonzaga
even... They'd be clamoring to get that team into a conference.
Does Gonzaga even have a college football program?
Yeah, that's a good question. I have no idea.
You know, I mean, at some point from a football standpoint, Kevin, just because of the number of rivalry games they're involved in, you're going to laugh when I say this. And I know that they've stayed independent forever. I get it. But do Army and Navy get pulled into one of them?
Yeah, that's it. And to that point, Jake, I'm curious, are there any package deals? Was USC and UCLA a package deal?
I think it was, right?
Is Oregon State a package deal?
I don't think Oregon State is. I think Oregon State would love for it to be.
Like Nathaniel brings up, I think, an interesting two-team duo of zero relevance in the college football world compared to what we've seen so far, but the peak relevance in college basketball, Duke and Carolina. The fallout from the ACC, and again, I brought up that grant rights thing earlier. Basically, the ACC has a TV contract through 2036 that, by all accounts, has binded these universities to that conference for the next, again, 14 years. Now, as we know, lawyers can get involved with this, and I'm sure there's some sort of buyout. It'd be very substantial. But in that conference, you mentioned Miami and Florida State. I think Clemson's got a little bit more national cachet than I think you do.
I mean, they do. Clemson does, Kevin. But I, if you're forecasting like 3 years from now, I think Clemson, the, in other words, you know for a fact, if Notre Dame goes 5-9 every year between now and 2025, they are still a massive brand in 2025.
Sure, sure, sure.
If Clemson goes 5-9 every year between now and 2025, they slide back into, you know, Michigan State territory.
Yeah, I think Notre Dame and Oregon are by far in a different stratosphere of teams that you would want to pursue. But man, it's going to be, what do you think the final number becomes?
Here's what I think.
20 in the Big Ten?
No, 22. I think the Big Ten is going to be, I actually sent this out yesterday. You ready? This is my, like.
Oh, yeah, my brother-in-law sent this to me, the one that finally introduced himself at the gym to you. Did you discuss this with him at the gym?
I did not. Did he send it to you like, what an idiot, or did he send
no,
it to
you? No, he goes, this is wild. He sent it to my other brother-in-law and father-in-law.
I think the Big Ten, and I just, Big Ten East, Ohio State, Michigan, Illinois, Michigan State, Purdue, Indiana, Northwestern, Maryland, Rutgers, and Penn State. Big Ten West, UCLA, USC, Arizona, Arizona State, Oregon, Washington, Wisconsin, Nebraska, Colorado, and Iowa. Now, I had forgotten to bring over Minnesota. So Minnesota would eliminate, let's
see
say.
See you, Gophers.
No, Minnesota obviously would still be in.
We've got Beaver Fever. We don't need the Gophers.
But that right there, something along those lines is what I think it'll end up being.
I saw yesterday, Jake, the road trip from UCLA to Rutgers would be longer than if Rutgers played a team in Iceland.
Yeah, I believe that. I mean, I saw it like the...
And that's where the Olympic sports thing, I just don't... Never utter the phrase student-athlete to me ever again.
Totally.
Because in what way, shape, or form should the, again, soccer, volleyball, insert your Olympic sport here, it makes sense to go play on a Tuesday night and travel from Bloomington to Los Angeles? And how many people are showing up to that game? Because when you think about Olympic sports, Jake, Olympic sports have much more of a regional roster feel to them. Like, you know, I mean, for most Olympic sports, you're mainly recruiting your own state and your kind of surrounding states. Whereas football, basketball have a little bit more of a national pull to it. You know, can you imagine your mom and dad traveling to watch you play?
I will say this, Kevin. In the initial years, UCLA and USC, and again, I think that we think like this is going to become like an annual home and home between Indiana and UCLA in football. I think it's going to be more so like these super conferences are going to be broken down into kind of sub packs.
You just can't play everybody.
Like, correct. Like, Indiana ain't going to be playing UCLA every single year, right?
How many times has IU played Nebraska?
But
so
when
far?
Indiana does play at UCLA in the Rose Bowl, there's going to be 5,000 to 10,000 Indiana fans that travel to go do it, right? It's the middle of November.
Now, how many UCLA fans are coming to Bloomington?
Ain't none.
For that game.
Right? Zero. Zilch, nada. None. But can you imagine, like,
sure,
if you're an Indiana fan, you're like, hell yeah, like, let's get a bunch of guys and go to UCLA and
make the shirts now. IU's in the Rose Bowl.
That's exactly right.
Right?
Joe Hall said it. Rose Bowl, first time since 67. Bring it, right?
He's Jake Query. I'm Kevin Bowen. Mark Dykton across the way. When we come back, it's going to be Ronald Nored, Pacers Summer League coach, at 8:30. Right now, coming up next, James Boyd from the Indianapolis Star. It was a quiet day one for the Pacers, a relatively quiet day in the NBA outside of Kevin Durant. We'll get James' thoughts on what that means for the Pacers. We'll do that next year on 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
School is in session.
Friend McCaffrey, I think reports of the Iowa demise are greatly exaggerated. Let's put it that way.
When we moved to town, Patrick was in fourth grade with the Murrays. To watch them be our two forwards is going to be really exciting. We got a few other guys like Tony Perkins from down your way, and he's really blossomed. And we got drivers, we got shooters, we got post-up players. I think we got some guys that can play.
Dan Dockage, weekdays noon to 3 on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
At Family Dollar, we know you want more for your summer. Find everything from grilling supplies and beach toys to deals on your favorite soft drinks. Family Dollar, helping you do more.
Hey, it's Jake Query. This Friday night, it's the craziest, too. And wildest night of the year at Circle City Raceway, a wild and unpredictable school bus figure eight race, plus an insane demo derby, school bus rides, and spectator drags. That's right. Bring your street legal car out. You can compete to win $250. Circle City Raceway at the Marion County Fairgrounds, racing all weekend on this, the fair's final 3 days. For more information, check them out on Facebook at Circle City Raceway. Nothing like racing on dirt this time of year. It's the best. And then Saturday night, the Tom Wood, that's tomorrow night, Tom Wood Group Indianapolis Speedrome, powered by Lincoln Tech. It's autograph night. Come out and meet the drivers. You can see the cars up close and personal, including their figure eight cars, which run that wild and unpredictable 75-lap feature on the figure eights on Saturday. Enjoy family-friendly racing action, great food, free parking, and outrageous fun. That's this Saturday at the Indianapolis Speedrome, the corner of Kittley and Brookville on Indy's southeast side. Info can be found at speedrome.com.
Charlie says sell it, so there's huge deals again this week at Payless Liquors. Southern Comfort 50-milliliter variety packs are only $4.69. Ready-to-drink 4-packs of Mom Water are $8.99. Crown Royal RTDs $12.99. Franzia Box Wine started only $14.99. And 18-packs of Bud Light and Coors Light are $14.99 for the 12-ounce cans, $19.99 for the 16-ouncers. And be sure to pick up some Evan Williams Black Label. The 1.75-liter bottle is only $22.99 at all 26 family-owned Payless Liquor locations. Don't pay more, get more, pay less at Payless Liquors.
In the construction business and tired of dealing with the indifference of big corporate suppliers, Quality Supply and Tool on South Harding Street understands. For over 25 years, owner Kevin Anne has had a different approach.
We at Quality Supply and Tool take pride in being a locally owned family business committed to service. And every customer's needs are different, and we truly believe in shaping our business to our customers' needs. That's what separates us from the competition.
That's Quality Supply and Tool, with additional locations in Bloomington and Jeffersonville to serve Hoosiers better. Partner with Quality Supply and Tool and think outside the box. Store.
Hey, tennis fans, with the BetRivers.com Sportsbook app, you can smash, slice, and spin your way to big tennis paydays. That's because we're serving up the excitement of live in-game betting, where you can bet on all the action, including point-by-point betting from tournaments around the world. Plus, with BetRivers' award-winning customer service, it's game, set, and match. Download the BetRivers.com Sportsbook app. It's a whole new game.
Must be 21. Must be located in Indiana. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-9-WITH-IT. 1-800-994-8448.
Here's what's happening with the Fan.
Hit the links at the Dan Dockage Annual Tom Dockage Memorial Golf Outing, presented by Franciscan Health, July 18th at Golf Club of Indiana. Call your buddies and register your team today. Remember to follow the Fan on all of your favorite social media platforms. The Fan is on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube. Like and follow the Fan to stay up to date on all of our giveaways and all things sports.
For more info, click on 1075thefan.com.
Terry Stacey with your American Standard Race Day weather, brought to you by B&W Plumbing, Heating, Cooling, and Drains. Independence Weekend features great road course racing. IndyCar is at Mid-Ohio Sunday at noon, partly sunny and 90 degrees at the green flag. Afterwards, the NASCAR guys are at Road America in Elkhart Lake, Wisconsin, partly sunny and a high of 82. This has been your race day weather, brought to you by B&W Plumbing, Heating, Cooling, and Drains, your independent American Standard heating and air conditioning dealer.
Hey, it's JMV for the absolute best in realty, Mark Deedle Realty. 317-755-4232. That's 317-755-4232. Online, markdeedle.com. That's markdeedle.com today. So, how about Paula, Teresa, in Edinburgh? They needed to move out of town, but first they needed to get top dollar in their existing home to afford the move. They had 21 acres out of the city, so it wasn't an easy sale. They reached out to Mark Deedle, and he listed and sold their home in a few weeks for $60,000 over their asking price for Paul and Teresa in Edinburgh. Mark Dietl has a guarantee for you. Multiple offers on your home in 3 days, or he is going to list it for free. That's Mark Dietl Realty, 317-755-4232, 317-755-4232. MarkDietl.com, that's Mark DietL.com today.
93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
WIBC HD2, W298BB, WIBC HD3, W228CX, Indianapolis.
The NTT IndyCar Series races on the road course at Mid-Ohio, Sunday at noon, on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
This the number one champion sound. Yeah, Estelle, we about to get down. Who the hottest in the world right now? Just touched down in London town.
You're listening to Kevin and Querry on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
I love this one from Chris. God help us. Does this mean Bill Walton will be calling Big Ten basketball games?
Well, that would be an experience, I'd say.
The Conference of Champions.
Yeah.
Is that no longer?
There's nothing better than Big Ten basketball.
Ronald Nored, Pacers Summer League coach, going to join us here at the bottom of the hour. Let's head to the Payless Liquors hotline right now to talk with James Boyd from the Indianapolis Star, who I think just had one of those days that I've had covering NFL free agency where you wait and you wait and you wait and nothing happens. Fans freak out and you reassess at about whatever, 1 a.m., 2 a.m., whenever bedtime is. James, appreciate you waking up with us because I'm sure you're kind of sitting there last night thinking, all right, is anything going to happen? And just when you go to bed, something breaks. I don't know how you felt, but when I saw the Durant news and Kevin Durant request that trade, and I think it broke around, I don't know, like 3 o'clock in the afternoon, part of me was like, it's going to be a quiet day in the NBA because a lot of teams are just going to be patient and see what happens with Durant and then kind of find themselves around those dominoes after that happens.
Exactly. Yeah, you're just waiting for him to set the market. It's like that at any sport, any league, you wait for the superstars to kind of figure out what they're going to do, and then everyone else kind of reacts to that. So we'll see. I definitely was shocked by it. I mean, you got Kyrie opting in one day and basically Kevin Durant opting out the next day. So crazy stuff. Definitely a player-led league. So when KD wants out, you basically have to listen and try to get what will likely be the greatest trade haul in NBA history.
You know, it's interesting to me, James, that, and I want your thoughts on this. Fans, and I understand it, start jumping up and down on the day one of free agency of, what are we doing? Why are they not doing anything? And then an hour later, they go, I can't believe they're still paying Monte Ellis. What a horrible signing that was. There's a balance there, right? Like, you don't want to knee-jerk. Mm-hmm. But if you're the Pacers, because this was kind of a short class in terms of impact players available, was there a window where they had to jump, or was this the smart play?
I think it was a smart play. I just think the average fan, and even myself before I got really immersed into the NBA, into the Pacers, you don't understand the intricacies of free agency, of contracts, and things like that. If you ask the average fan about Monte Ellis, they're not going to even bring up the fact that he's still on the books until, the clock, the calendar flipped to today. So it's all about being patient and understanding that, you know, the team is probably making calls and feeling things around the league. But, again, you kind of have to wait until that superstar decides where the heck he's going to go, and then you can kind of figure out what you're going to do. The one thing I will say is with some of the moves that have happened around the league, even without the Kevin Durant news, is, you know, you're looking around with other teams. It's like, okay, is there a Malcolm Brogdon partner out there? It seems like that market is kind of dwindled a little bit. So we'll see what they could, you know, get in return for him.
I'm going to be the old guy in the room here. Let me tell you one thing, James Boyd, that befuddles me, and you tell me the easy answer here. I'm befuddled by the fact that Kevin Durant, I know he's a superstar, I know he's a mainline player, but Kevin Durant comes out and says, you know what, I want to be traded. And that's just an automatic of, okay, well, then I guess we're done here. Let's move him along. And I get it. I get that you don't want a malcontent on your team or a guy that doesn't want to be there. But I'm old enough to remember an era where players didn't dictate that. Have we completely gone away from that? Do players now hold franchises hostage as opposed to the other way around?
Yeah. Well, the one thing I'll say is that they're the 1% of the 1% can do this. Kevin Durant, LeBron James, Luka Doncic, Giannis, like all those guys, they control the NBA. They control the league. So obviously it won't be every player, but I do think that, you know, if KD wants out, KD can do whatever he wants, because you have to look at it like, okay, I can tell him he has to stay with us. He can be upset about it. He still has 4 years left on his deal, whatever, whatever. Or you can look at it like, hey, we can get the greatest, you know, jump start on a rebuild if we want to go that route by getting a bunch of first-round draft picks and some really good players in return. So that's the other side of it. But, yeah, I definitely think that era is over. I think, you know, LeBron basically started it with I'm going to determine my own legacy. I'm going to go out there and join whatever team I want. And then now it's become to the point where, I mean, you sign the deal, and then if you want out 2 years later, you can do that. I mean, people were criticizing Bradley Beal yesterday for signing that Supermax with Washington, but in my mind, I'm thinking, all right, you just sign for the money, and then if you don't want to be there in a year or two, you just tell the team that, then you get a short list of teams you can go to. So, I mean, if you're an old school type of guy, or it might not, you know, be something you're okay with, but that's the NBA, and I don't think it's going to change. I know there'll probably be a lockout when they have to do some CBA agreements again, but at the end of the day, the players will decide most of the things in the NBA for sure.
He's at Romeoville Kid on Twitter. James Boyd with us here. Again, covers the Pacers for the Star. James, one last thing on the Durant front for me. The other thing I thought of when I saw that news is this is good for the Pacers. The Pacers, unlike 90% of the NBA, are in a favorable cap situation right now. So when this Durant trade goes down, if it needs to involve another team, which you got to feel like in all likelihood it will based off his contract and how many years are left and where he would want to go, the Pacers can kind of insert the picture and say, hello, we can provide cap relief and then benefit from that. Do you see, or could you see, the Pacers getting involved kind of a la what they did with the James Harden, Caris LeVert thing a couple years ago?
Yeah, I could definitely see that happen just because, you know, you want to take advantage of whatever what happens around the league as well. So I do think because of having that cap space, you at least have to inquire and see, you know, can we eat a couple, you know, expiring contracts this year, and because of that, acquire some other picks or something like that. So that's the one thing that kind of raised my eyebrows, is like, like if it's any other player besides, you know, a top 10 guy, maybe you don't, you know, have to make those calls. But again, it's hard for me to see that, you know, one team can give up enough to get Kevin Durant. Like, it's probably possible. I would say that it's more likely that they try to do a deal straight up with Phoenix or something like that, just because of what they could get in return as far as young players and draft picks, things like that. But I do think that the Pacers could definitely be, you know, sort of a trade facilitator, but also it kind of has to, that'll basically, in my opinion, show their hand as to what they want to do this season. Like, if you want to be able to get a bunch of young assets and eat a bunch of bad contracts and be bad for another year to be good in the long run, that to me would probably be a good move long term. But I don't know. I feel like the Pacers are pretty conservative, so we might see them do a couple of moves here or there just to try to get back to the playoffs as quick as possible.
Again, James Boyd from the Stars with us. And James, I know you're not too familiar, at least I don't think, with the Colts and how kind of their operation runs, but Chris Bauer, their GM, he doesn't care what position guys play. If you're a great player, we're going to invest in you. So when it comes time for contracts, you know, I'll pay a guard big money. I'll pay a running back big money. With Kevin Pritchard, do you get any sense of that? And I ask it because of DeAndre Ayton. And if you were to make a trade for a guy like him, James, you're going to have to give him a max contract. And you obviously, from a cap situation standpoint, would be investing a large chunk into a position in center that is not top of mind right now in the NBA. So in your conversations with Kevin and just how the NBA operates in today's league, do you get any sense that there would be some pause there in investing so much into that position?
Yeah, I mean, obviously this time of year, he's not, you know, I'm just not calling him up every single day or seeing what's going on. it's a little more, you know, formal. But I will say that just from the outside looking in and from my own perspective on DeAndre Ayton, and I wrote about this, you really have to be sold on him. Basically, you would have to say, him and Haliburton are going to be our 1-2 punch, because Aiden's going to command the max deal, and then next summer Tyrese is going to be eligible for his rookie extension. So, I mean, do you think that's a 1-2 punch to be good enough to contend, or are either one of those guys good enough to be the best player on the championship team? I don't think so. But if your goal is to just be – look at it like this. If your goal is to get back into the playoffs and be a pretty good team, that's, those two are pretty good pieces to build around. If your goal is to try to get a superstar, then we know in Pacer land, the best way to do that is to go through the draft and get a Reggie Miller, get a Paul George. So it's either, in my opinion, you're either going to ship out this money for Aiden and be, you know, pretty good, probably, you know, be able to make the playoffs, or – you go the opposite route and you just bottom out, you know, like the OKCs, like the Detroits, like the Houstons, and you get those multiple top five picks in a few years, and you try to, you know, swing and hit on a superstar. So I would say that they're probably more conservative. I don't necessarily think that they will go out and pay Aiden a max contract, mainly because the history says that they haven't. But it is interesting because they could, I mean, they could sign him straight up, or they could package him. I would think the Suns would probably want to do like a sign and trade to get something in return, maybe a Miles Turner. He would definitely be an upgrade from Miles Turner. But again, is that good enough to really push you into the upper echelon, or is it just good enough for you to get back into the playoffs?
Were you surprised Jalen Smith's name was not bubbled about at all yesterday?
Yeah, I really was, because he's an unrestricted free agent. I know with some restricted free agents, you couldn't extend a qualifying offer, I believe, until today. And even then, you basically can wait until, I believe, the 6th to really offer them. And then there's like a 48-hour window for the other team to match. So I can understand why some restricted free agents weren't offered. But unrestricted free agent, I was kind of shocked. But it also lets me know, like, okay, not only looking at the market for Jalen Smith, what's the market for T.J. Warren? I'm looking at some of these guys who got deals yesterday, and I'm like, man, like, you know, I thought you had a few fans thought I was crazy that I wouldn't offer T.J. Warren $10 million a year. And it's like, I'm looking at guys who played last year, wings, you know, who played last year, and they're getting $8 million. You know, Captain Kevin Knox got a deal for 2 years, $6 million. So these are things that definitely are kind of surprising. Well, Jalen Smith is the one that, you know, I expected some movement from him, but in all likelihood, that's a good sign for Indiana fans, because he hasn't been picked up yet. Maybe he is thinking about coming back, but obviously, there's a lot of, you know, time left for agency, kind of drags along. And again, it could be one of those things where teams are just waiting to see what Kevin Durant does, and then they'll go out and kind of get some of those, you know, peripheral pieces.
Is it possible, James, is it possible that in the case of Jalen Smith, that teams backed off because they've already been given indication that he is going to re-sign a one-year deal with Indiana?
Yeah, I mean, that could be a possibility. Again, I think that would take an extreme amount of trust on Jalen's part. And honestly, a really bad gamble. Like, I mean, I think the guy is a stand-up guy, but I just don't see how you can look around the league and see other guys getting, you know, more security, more money, and you're willing to gamble on a one-year, $4.6 million deal. You know, in a perfect world, you sign – you don't get hurt, things go well, and, you know, even, you know, in a few years down the line, you're looking back and you're saying, hey, I stayed with the team I wanted to, I got this money, whatever, whatever, but it's not a perfect world. I mean, even if he were to come back on a one-year deal, the year after that, the Pacers could only offer him $6 million. Like, they'd still be handicapped in what they could offer him. And so, you know, 2 years ago, T.J. Warren was lighting it up in the bubble, so a lot can change, you know what I mean? So I think that I still would lean towards him, you know, seeking more money and more security with a longer deal and obviously a bigger payday.
Again, James Boyd is with us from the Indianapolis Star covering the Pacers. He is at Romeoville Kid on Twitter. James, I don't know about you. I've had to deadbolt the house the last couple of nights after my Lance Stevenson thoughts earlier in the week, and reading your story on Lance, boy, I can only imagine what the app mentions look like for you. You and I are in the same boat on this. You know, Lance, a hell of a run at times, lit up Banker's Life and Gainbridge Fieldhouse that really not many have over the last 5 to 10 years. I've kind of explained my message. Hopefully you can share yours on exactly why you feel like it's time to move on from Lance.
Yeah, so just to clarify for everyone out there, it's not a hit piece. Like, I didn't say, you know, Lance is terrible, don't bring him back. No, I basically said, Lance is too good to sit on the bench for you. That's my thinking. They have a bunch of ball handlers already. I mean, you got T.J. McConnell, Tyrese Haliburton, Benedict Mathurin, Andrew Nimhard, which they just drafted, Malcolm Brogdon still for now, Chris Duarte. So you have a bunch of people on the wings and in the backcourt, and it makes me think, like, of all the guys I just named, and I'm probably missing a few, it's like, would you play Lance Stephenson over them? I believe he played about 19 minutes per game last season with the Pacers. That would be way too many this upcoming season if you're trying to really invest in your young guys. So my thinking was like, you know, I understand that Lance would probably welcome coming back and being that locker room presence, being that end of the bench guy. But from a pure joy standpoint, everyone knows Lance gets his juice from playing, from the air guitars, from the shimmies, from those things that only happen when you're playing the game. And I think he proved to the NBA that he can be a productive NBA player. He just has to kind of do it, I think, on a team where he'd have more of a leash to actually go out there and play the game. Now, I know fans keep mentioning, you know, he could be our Udonis Haslem. Udonis Haslem is 41. He has not played over 30 games in 6 years. Like, Lance Stephenson is 31. So, to me, I feel like it's disrespectful for fans to tell me, hey, he could just be our UD. It's like, no, he can still actually play basketball. He still has some juice left in the tank. So I think he will probably be happier if he could go somewhere, I know, outside of Indy, where he gets his superpowers and all that, but, you know, have a chance to actually play the game he loves. Because Lance, I mean, he's a player. Like, you think of players, you think of, you know, people that go into coaching afterwards, he maybe could fit that mold, but everyone knows, like, Lance is a showman, and you can only really be a showman if you're playing. So I think that's my whole argument is, like, he's too good to sit on the bench, but he's also, you know, maybe a little too old in just the timeline of where he is with the rest of the team to keep him around and justify playing him over your younger guys.
The who is James Boyd. The what is he is the beat writer for the Indianapolis Star of the Indiana Pacers. And the where is he's on the Payless Liquors guest line. James, kind of a two-part question here, but I look at – so I guess three-part question. I look at, like, Kyle Anderson, Bobby Portis, guys like that that were not huge ticket items. But what they bring to the table in terms of being kind of that two-way Swiss Army knife, know their role kind of guy, that those are the kind of players that I felt like Indiana needed to use free agency to bolster their roster with. A, do you agree with that assessment? And B, if you do, where do they still find those guys?
Yeah, I do. It's funny you said that because I had to make a list of like five free agents for the Pacers to kind of look at. And obviously DeAndre Ayton was one of them. And two of them were Portis and Kyle Anderson. I do think that there are still some options out there, some lower level options, and probably some gambles. You've got Jarrett Culver, who is in a similar situation as like Jalen Smith. You know, the high draft pick hasn't really worked out. He's a wing guy. Do you bring him in on a cheap deal? And if he, you know, if he plays well, then great. If he doesn't, then you didn't spend a lot of money on him. Another guy I would think of or kind of throw out there is Jordan Nora from Milwaukee. He's a restricted free agent. But considering that Milwaukee just brought back a bunch of guys yesterday, paid Bobby Portis more money to stay, I do think that he's less of a priority for them. And he's a guy that's, you know, he's 23, he's 6'8", he's got good length, good athleticism, he can shoot the three ball. He's going into his third season, and it's like, man, well, would he want a bigger role? He's won a championship in Milwaukee. Granted, he wasn't really, like, in, like, the rotation for that. But, you know, he got an NBA championship already. And now he's looking for a bigger payday, bigger role. And he's young enough to kind of join that rebuild in Indiana. And you can feel good about, you know, hey, if we strike with this guy, is he someone that we could build around, you know, with our other guys long term? So there are still some options out there. I just think that there might be maybe less experienced options out there. But at the same time, if you want to stay young, there are some guys I think you just have to throw them a little more money than their competition. But, yeah, I definitely think that they have to – my thinking is that their priority needs to be getting some threes and fours on the roster because that's the biggest hole and the biggest, you know, need for this team.
Again, at Romeoville Kid on Twitter, NBA Summer League begins a week from today, day two of free agency underway. James Boyd has you covered there at the Indianapolis Star. James, I know it's a busy time, so appreciate you waking up with us this morning, and good luck with all your coverage.
Yeah, I appreciate it. You know, we got the first summer league practice today. We'll be talking to Ronald Nored. I know you guys are talking to him. We'll be talking to him later today this afternoon, and then summer league next week. I'll be out in Vegas and get that first look at Benedict Mathurin and some Pacers gear. So it should be a fun time.
Yeah, I think it's one week from today. I think it's a 6 o'clock game, I believe, Eastern time. So yeah, the first look there at the 6th overall pick. Safe travels, James.
All right, thank you all so much.
James Boyd right there on the Payless Liquors hotline. Again, Ronald Nored in about 5 minutes. Did want to slide in this one from Chris. He goes, if the Pacers re-sign Jalen Smith, does that change their outlook on Miles Turner? Are they now actively shopping him or no? I would say it would have little impact. Because remember, if you re-sign Jalen Smith, it's just a one-year deal. So there's no guarantee that he's certainly here long-term for you. So I think with Miles Turner, it's what Chad Buchanan said to Jake's question earlier in the week. By no means are they actively putting him out there. They would like to see him back. They'd like to see him with Tyrese Haliburton. But at the same time, if another team inquires about Miles Turner, they're going to open their ears and listen.
Yeah, I mean, listen, we're going to go through another year, are we not? Of like, we're just going to give it a couple months and find out where Miles Turner slots in.
Yeah, the Turner trade talk now is going to be less of him or Domas and just, is he going to stay here post this contract year? That will be the discussion this coming season. All right, time for a morning checkdown.
The morning checkdown.
Omaha!
Brought to you by QC Kinetics, relieving your joint pain at QCKinetics.com on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
Major League Baseball yesterday, we're not discussing one of the games, but the Pirates over the Brewers, 8-7. It was the Dodgers over the Padres, 3-1. Astros over the Yankees, 2-1. Astros have owned the Yankees lately. Indianapolis Indians over the Nashville Sounds, 4-3.
Thank you, Mark. Appreciate that. Mid-Ohio this week for
restraint.
Jake. That took a lot of maturation there by Mark Dykton. The IndyCar schedule back on the track. What, 3 week break? And then next week they'll be off. And then after that, a really busy close to July and August. So Mid-Ohio there, the road course for IndyCar this weekend.
NBA free agency, you've just heard us talking about it with James Boyd. Among the notables that yesterday came to agreements with teams, the following are staying with their existing teams, so no huge news. Ja Morant, Nikola Jokic, Karl Anthony Towns, all of them got huge money, by the way. Nicholas Batum, who was one of them that I kind of liked for the Pacers, signing a two-year deal to stay with the Clippers. Chris Boucher, whose brother Bobby is still down in the Bayou, signed a three-year, $32.5 million deal to stay in Toronto. Notables also Gary Harris, local product, two-year, $26 million deal to stay in Orlando. P.J. Tucker is leaving for Philadelphia. And Kyle Anderson, who I thought was a good fit for the Pacers, two-year, $18 million in Minnesota.
Yeah, Thad Young, nice deal with Toronto as well. 2 years, $16 million there for the 34-year-old. Thad Young. All right, we come back here on Kevin and Querry. Ronald Nored, former Butler player, a key cog on both of those teams that made it to the national championship game. And the head coach of the Pacers Summer League team, he's had an early morning. Did I hear that correctly, Jake?
He has been in there for 2.5 hours now, right?
A little workout time with one of the...
He was at work before we were this morning.
One of the key Pacers players. We'll talk with him about that next. Ronald Nored joins us here on Kevin and Querry, 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
Hey, it's Jake Querry. This Saturday night, it's Indy's loudest and wildest fireworks show, plus late model figure eight action at the Indianapolis Speedrome. Times, tickets, and more at speedrome.com.
It's a granddaddy of a sale.
Rolby Windows.
Up to 50% off, plus manufacturer's rebates and no interest, no payments for 18 months.
America's leading internet provider just got even faster. Switch to Spectrum Internet, and you now get starting speeds of up to 300 megabits per second. Faster speeds for streaming, faster speeds for gaming, faster speeds for working or learning, all with 99.9% network reliability. So no matter what you do online, you can do it better, safer, and now even faster with Spectrum Internet. Visit Spectrum.com for details. Based on internet subscribers among top ISPs, speeds may vary. Restrictions apply.
Hi, I'm Ryan Kelly with TheHomeLoanExpert.com. The housing market has started to cool, but inventory is still low and homes are selling fast. We need to get you pre-approved today. The Home Loan Expert has lower rates, loan programs for almost everyone, and a 10-day closing guarantee. We can answer all your questions and make sure you're ready to close the deal when that perfect home hits the market. The 10-day closing guarantee, only available at thehomeloanexpert.com. The Home Loan Expert LLC, NMLS number 1326241.
Charlie says sell it, so there's huge deals again this week at Payless Liquors. Southern Comfort 50 milliliter variety packs are only $4.69. Ready to drink 4 packs of Mom Water are $8.99. Crown Royal RTDs $12.99. Franzia Box Wine start at only $14.99. And 18 packs of Bud Light and Coors Light are $14.99 for the 12-ounce cans, $19.99 for the 16-ouncers. And be sure to pick up some Evan Williams Black Label. The 1.75 liter bottle is only $22.99 at all 26 family-owned Payless Liquor locations. Don't pay more, get more, pay less at Payless Liquors.
Hey, tennis fans, with the BetRivers.com Sportsbook app, you can smash, slice, and spin your way to big tennis paydays. That's because we're serving up the excitement of live in-game betting, where you can bet on all the action, including point-by-point betting from tournaments around the world. Plus, with BetRivers award-winning customer service, it's game, set, and match. Download the BetRivers.com Sportsbook app. It's a whole new game.
Must be 21. Must be located in Indiana. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-9-WITH-IT. 1-800-994-8448.
Hey, this is Lisa Stofan. Heard the Mark Patrick weight loss hypnosis hype? Well, I attended because my father stopped smoking with hypnosis. Hypnosis eliminated my desire for soda and fast food, made me want to exercise, and I lost 60 pounds in 6 months. My energy level exploded. I went to another session to deal with some other problem foods, and I lost another 10 pounds. In fact, I brought my husband. He lost weight. More important, cholesterol and blood pressure improved. My friend went, and she lost 20 pounds in the first 2 months. So does Mark Patrick hypnosis work? Oh yeah, it works. Nothing has changed my life more. Well, except maybe my husband. He's so proud of me. Makes me cry.
Join Mark Patrick seminars and lose the weight or stop smoking guaranteed for only $49.99. Hypnosis to destroy unwanted cravings. July 28th at the Hampton Inn and Suites in Fishers. Weight loss seminar 5:30 to 7:30 p.m. Stop smoking seminar 8 to 10 p.m. And Saturday, July 30th at the La Quinta Inn and Suites South in Indianapolis. Weight loss seminar 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Stop smoking seminar 2 to 4 p.m. Registration begins 30 minutes before seminar.
Put on your helmet. It's about to get real.
Joe writes, we're close to camp. What's a player doing, not only physically, mentally, what are guys doing right now?
Yeah, I always felt like once the 4th of July hit, you kind of say to yourself, all right, it's time to go. Because then you got 2 to 3 weeks left from training camp. That's when you start getting those butterflies every day when you wake up because you're excited to get up there to Grand Park, locked and loaded for what hopefully should be a really good cold season.
Dan Dockage, weekdays noon to 3 on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan. It's Kevin and Querry on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
Half past eight. We are halfway home on a Friday. Jake Querry along with Kevin Bowen. Mark Dykton here as well. It is Kevin and Querry. The incredibly appropriately named, creatively named Kevin and Querry program here, 93.5, 107.5. The Fan joining us now in the Payless Liquors guest line. He's been at work for 6.5 hours this morning. Got there at 2 in the morning and started working out players. Ronald Nored, who will be coaching the Pacers in Summer League. And my understanding is, Ronald, that it was an early morning at a coffee house with you and Tyrese Haliburton getting in caffeine and jumpers. Is that right?
Yeah, 2 o'clock is probably a little ambitious, but yeah, 7:38 is about right.
Again, he's Ronald Nored, obviously former Butler player, and he's with us here on the Payless Liquors Hotline. He's going to be coaching the Pacers Summer League. First practice today, first game a week from today. Ronald, I wanted to get your thoughts on Benedict Mathurin and just watching him in the draft process, any interactions with him when he worked out a couple weeks ago, and just your opinion on what you guys are getting in the Arizona product.
I'm really excited about Ben. I think we all are. I was actually fortunate to go to Mexico a couple weeks ago with the NBA Basketball Without Borders to the NBA Academy down there. And that was the first time I had really heard about Ben because he was in the Academy. So hearing from all of our NBA international people about how great of a guy he is, how hard of a worker he is, how much he cares about the game, and just how talented he is, it got me excited. And then he came here to work out, and I kind of had that in the back of my mind already. And he came here and had a great workout, and obviously we took him on draft day. So this is a big excitement, great day for our organization. We all kind of get to see him live for the first time in a 5-on-5 situation. So we're expecting a lot from him, and we're excited about him.
What are the main things, Ronald, in Summer League? What are the main things that you or the franchise are looking for? Because when you look at other players that are signed for summer league, which is more true? A, they are players that you need to push those that are already on your roster over the course of the summer to make them better, or B, you are legitimately looking for guys that might have slipped through the cracks that could help out your team in the regular season?
Yeah, that's a great A and B. I really think it's a little bit of both. And when I think about that, I think about Terry Taylor, who's currently on our roster. Terry Taylor played for our summer, or he was on our summer league team last year. He played 0 minutes, zero. He comes to camp. He ends up going to play for the Mad Ants. One of the best players in the G League last year. And then he ends up making our roster, and he made a tremendous impact on our team at the end of the year last year. But that all started in summer league. And so, we are looking for, you know, guys who can overall make our team better, including some of our own players, guys that we drafted, guys that are coming back for a second year. But we're also seeing if we can find some guys, you know, some diamonds in the rough, similar to Terry Taylor, that can be a part of our organization for many years to come.
Again, he's Ronald Nored, coaching the Pacers summer league team, and obviously a Butler product. And Ronald, I'm kind of a loser, and I get down these YouTube rabbit holes at times. And a few weeks ago, I got down one where I'm looking up Butler highlights from the run to the national title game. I come across you guys against Syracuse in the Sweet 16, and I see you step into a three-pointer with about 3 minutes to go in the game. And you've got the confidence like you're Steph Curry stepping into one. And this is when you guys are down four. And I'm thinking to myself, of all these Butler magical moments in that two-year run, I don't know if that play gets enough credit of you stepping up, hitting a huge three against Syracuse when you guys were a bit on the ropes there. I'm curious when you think back on those runs, if that play or that moment, or what moment, I guess, pops into your mind.
I appreciate you saying that. Most of the time nowadays when people talk about, you know, my career, namely this guy named Brad Stevens, he talks about how poorly of a shooter that I was and a player that I was. And I like to remind him that if I'm that bad, he's the dummy that played me.
Good point.
But that being said, that's my favorite game that I played in my 4 years at Butler, was that Syracuse game. And for a lot of reasons, but having that opportunity in that moment, I know we were down four. Syracuse plays their zone out of bounds under. I knew the play that Brad was going to call, and the play is actually for Shelvin to catch the ball. He was going to inbound it, and then we were going to swing the ball around, and he was going to catch it on the other side of the court for him to get an open three. But I knew I had the first touch, and I said, man, if these guys back up, I'm going to step into the shot, and I'm going to shoot it. And I did, and it went in, and Willie Beasley followed it up with a shot that hit the front of the rim, right, the backboard, and then rolled in. And, you know, we advanced to the Elite Eight from that game. But there were so many great moments from that tournament. That was a great personal one for me. Another one was Murray State had the chance to kind of seal the game with a game-winning, I think, and-one layup in the round of 32. But just getting the opportunity to play in Indy in front of all the fans here, getting to practice in front of, you know, 20,000 people, however many it was just a special, special time.
Yeah, the favorite sporting event that I've been to is certainly that national championship game against Duke. Part of the reason that I bring this up, Ronald, is obviously a couple months ago when Butler has that opening and Thad Matta becomes the head coach. Did you have any interest in that? Did you talk to Barry Collier at all about that opening?
Yeah, I spoke to him briefly. You know, I'll say I'm super excited for Thad. I'm super excited for Butler. Thad is obviously one of the best coaches in college basketball, you know, in our time, if not ever. And it's a great hire for Butler. And, you know, we already see through the portal some of the things that they've been able to do and some of the players they've been able to get. And so I think the future is super bright for the Bulldogs. I'm excited about it. Thad is a great guy. I haven't had a ton of interactions with him, you know, over the years, but I've had enough, and Brad speaks so highly of him. So I'm super excited for the Bulldogs and Thad, and it's going to be a couple great years ahead.
Ronald Nored is our guest, by the way, who is an assistant coach for the Pacers and will be coaching them in summer league. I'm curious about this. You were and I hope you get what I'm saying here, you were a Bulldog type player. And I don't mean that in a Butler sense. I mean, you were probably a little undersized, but as you know, you talked about you weren't a great shooter, but you just had this knack, right? Like, you were just one of those guys you had to keep on the floor. So when you are coaching and looking at aspiring players, does that more so, A, that mentality you had as a player, does it more so, A, assist you because you have an innate ability to recognize that in guys that other people may overlook, or B, frustrate you because you assume everybody has the same drive Ronald Nored did, and quite frankly, it doesn't always exist?
Yeah, I think it's A for sure. The interesting thing about B is, you know, us that played the game, and actually Shaka Smart is the one it was a guy that worked with Shaka Smart when he was at Texas, said to me, you know, the problem with you former players that coach is all you guys were kind of like you said, you were the bulldogs, you were the best listener, you were the most well coached, and you expect everyone to be like you. And you know, the longer that you're in it, you realize that everyone's not like that. And so the important thing in that is just to be able to connect with each guy, know how each guy ticks. You know, everyone's looking to get better, especially at our level. And it's just about finding a way to help them improve, to help the team improve. And so, yeah, there's times where, you know, you wish, you know, you could get a little bit more out of a guy, but you have to let people be who they are. And if you allow people to be who they are, then they'll perform the best for you.
Again, Ronald Nored is with us, Pacers assistant. Summer league practice underway today, and early morning on the floor with Tyrese Haliburton for Ronald Nored before he gets his hands on the rookies. And next week, it'll be Vegas. A week from today, actually, will be their first game. Ronald, you and I are about the same age, and I thought to myself the first year out of college, boy, I am swimming upstream. I'm just trying to survive. This house that I'm living in Butler is going to burn down one of these Friday or Saturday nights. And there you are coaching Brownsburg High School basketball. What is your biggest takeaway from that? And, like, I'm kind of curious to go back to that process of, like, when did your Butler career end? And then how quickly did it realize of, like, oh, my gosh, yeah, I'm going to coach high school basketball at a really high level?
Yeah, I was really, really fortunate to get that job. Found out about that. We're getting on the bus to go to Valparaiso for our conference tournament my senior year, and my goal was to be on the Butler staff, and I think Brad was going to work out a way to make that happen. But as I was getting on the bus to go to the conference tournament up in Valpo, Brad said, "Hey, after the tournament, I want to talk to you. Come by the house." And he had never asked me to come by his house ever before, or anyone, as far as I know. So after the tournament, day after we lose, I go up to his house, and he says, "Hey, I talked to the superintendent of Brownsburg, a guy named Jim Snapp. He's still the superintendent there, and he wants to hire you as the head coach for Brownsburg High School." You know, and I play with Gordon, so my information about Brownsburg was all through Gordon, right? And I knew they had won the state championship in 2008. This was 2012. And so I was like, man, a head high school coach right away. And I really wanted to go to Butler, but I decided, you know what? I'm just going to go on the fire and be a high school coach, a head coach. I was a head coach of an AAU team while I was playing. So I thought I'd just roll right into Brownsburg High School. And my biggest takeaway from that was how important it is in a high school job to get the community involved, number one. Number two, how difficult it can be in a high school to get people with a lot of agendas to come together. And, you know, that's actually translated to when I was coaching the G League, that's translated to the NBA. And number three, how not to screw things up when you're the head coach. And my best example of that, I actually received a text from one of my Brownsburg guys yesterday when he found out I was coaching the summer league team. We played in the county tournament at against Avon, and we were supposed to wear white, and we brought only black jerseys. Well, Avon was also wearing black jerseys, and it was hard to differentiate between Brownsburg and Avon, and we received a technical for that. So I learned things like that, not to screw things up and think deeply about things and how things work. So that's probably my biggest takeaway.
Ronald, when you look at, you know, that Butler team, that Butler group that you played on, and not to sit here and belabor the point, right, about Butler, but A, people around here know about those teams, and B, I think it's a blueprint of how teams can be built, and I think Brad Stevens was so good at meshing personalities. I think Pat Riley does that really well as well in building teams, of just finding that cohesiveness. When you look at this Pacers roster as it stands right now, give me a player that you played with at Butler. And the obvious answer here is going to be Gordon Hayward because he's an NBA player. But in terms of their style, what they brought to the table for your Butler teams, the way that they interacted on the floor with their teammates, what player's style of play at Butler would be the one that you would most plug in for this Pacers roster to complete what you guys are trying to do?
Matt Howard. I think the toughness that he brings, the work on a day-to-day basis, his ability to connect the team through just the way he plays and the impact that he has in the game is just tremendous. And I do think we have those guys here, but you can never have enough of those guys. And, you know, obviously Gordon and Shelvin were both NBA players. Matt was a 10 or 11 year pro. And we had good players, but the kind of person and player and teammate that Matt Howard was and is exactly what would be great for our team.
Do you feel, as a summer league coach, Ronald Nored, do you feel a responsibility if you have a young player on the Pacers summer league roster that you know there's not an opening for him with the Pacers organization, but that he may have a role elsewhere in the NBA? How do you draw the line between facilitating that player's opportunity elsewhere and also at the same time not handing over a really nice piece to an opponent that might hurt you over the course of the long run?
Yeah, I think the important thing for us, you know, big picture, what is Summer League for? What are we trying to get out of it? Is we are trying to get our guys that are on our roster that are young familiar with what the NBA game is about. And we've talked a lot about that as a staff as we prepare, like what NBA defenses do, what NBA offenses do, so that when the season starts, they already have a leg up. They already have a foot up. And so to answer that question, it's important for the guys that are not those guys and already on our roster to try to, again, be who they are, be the best they can be, play as well as they can in Vegas. And then whatever happens, happens from there. You know, one of the things that I enjoy about coaching Summer League is we get to try to do our best to help guys, put guys in a position to be successful, to go out to Vegas. All 30 NBA teams are going to be there. They get to be seen. And so, you know, I know our guys are smart enough upstairs to figure out if a guy's good enough to keep him around and if he fits to keep him around. But there's other teams that are doing that as well. And so it's just on us to just try to help them be the best they can be. And then whatever happens from there happens.
Ronald, last one from us. In 5 to 10 years, where do you hope to be professionally?
I hope to be an NBA head coach.
You think that's possible?
I think it's possible, sure. It's really difficult to do. I mean, there's 30 of them in the world, and it takes a lot of work. And there's a lot of great coaches. And so, you know, for me, it's more about just working, being in positions where I can just get better. And then if it happens, kind of like I was saying about those players, if that opportunity comes about, then great. But, you know, that's what I aspire to be, and that's what I work hard to do one day. And, you know, God willing, it'll happen.
Do you have to go back now to shooting baskets with Tyrese Haliburton?
I don't. We're done for the day. He's probably running around, you know, cracking jokes and making everybody smile. But it's we start practice here in a little bit, and so – it's time to get to work.
But it's pretty encouraging, is it not, that in the first day of July, like before 9 o'clock in the morning, the guy that's theoretically the next face of the franchise is in there shooting baskets at 7:30 in the morning?
It's super encouraging. And I'll say about Ty, he's one of the best that I've ever been around. His impact on people is very understated. I mean, it is a real thing. He lights up the gym. He lights up every room that he's a part of. He's a real leader, a real person, and he's a heck of a player that's going to make the Indiana Pacers really, really good.
Terrific stuff from Ronald Nored this morning. And again, I hope that I carry the same confidence he had stepping into that jumper against Syracuse in every little walk of life here moving forward. Ronald, enjoy today. Safe travels to Vegas next week. And good luck with everything moving forward.
Thanks, guys. Appreciate you guys having me on today.
That's Ronald Nored right there on the Payless Liquors hotline. Jake, it's funny you think back on those Butler runs. the Duke game, rightfully so, gets so much attention. Was it Andrew Smith that had a tip-in to beat Pittsburgh or Old Dominion?
It's Matt Howard, wasn't it?
Was it Howard?
Yeah.
The Pittsburgh game had the wild finish, where like fouls on both ends and they're both going to the foul line. You think back to those games.
Yeah, they were nanoseconds on two occasions from being bounced.
Remember the name Krishan Hopkins?
Yep. Locally.
Yeah, Emmanuel came in against Florida. Hadn't played in a while. Hit some big shots for him. It's funny, when I got in that rabbit hole on YouTube and I looked back at that Syracuse game, I mean, they're down four with 3 minutes to go in the game, and here's Nored shooting a three. Like, there's still a good amount on the shot clock. I'm thinking, bad shot, and boom, he steps into it, hits that shot. And that was against the number one seed. And at the time, you know, Butler was still a little Cinderella-y of like, all right, Sweet 16, they're the five seed, Syracuse is the one seed. And that just sparked one of the more incredible runs you'll ever see, frankly, in March Madness history.
Pretty fun stuff in those days for sure. And Ronald Nored, listen, I'd love to see him be an NBA head coach one day, right? On the right path for certain.
22 years old, Jake, head coach of the Brownsburg Bulldogs. At 22, what were you doing?
At 22? I was ringing groceries about 80% at about an 80% rate accuracy for college students in Bloomington.
You can't put eggs under detergent, my friend.
80% accuracy. Bananas, okay. Looks like meat to me, whatever.
That prime rib there just got rang up as some Salisbury steak now, didn't it?
You squished my prunes.
No, I wasn't bagging groceries, Mark. I was ringing. I had escalated beyond that.
Oh, you'd upgrade
now. Now, I will say, when scanning groceries, there might have been some detergent that went on top of the eggs over the
now,
scanner.
Now, would your buddies come in and be like, hey, we got to go to aisle three, Jake, or we got to go to lane three there to get
I can
Jake.
Say this now. I'm not proud of it. I will say that working at a grocery store in college, the entire grocery store was college students.
Mm-hmm.
And there was definitely a symbiotic relationship between, like, say, the guy that was, you know, working in the deli, and the guy, you know, college was all about looking out for each other.
Yeah, certainly.
I will leave it at that.
Price check on Crest toothpaste. Price check.
Do we have
Crest
any cameras
toothpaste
of the query scan line there?
I have. Is that scan or scam? Which one did you go with then?
Probably a little bit of both.
All right.
Thank you to Ronald Nored for joining us. That'll be up on the podcast. We're going to have Aaron Torres talk a little college football, the craziness of yesterday, and USC and the UCLA news coming up in about 10 minutes here on 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
Terry Stacey with your American Standard Race Day weather, brought to you by B&W Plumbing, Heating, Cooling, and Drains. Independence Weekend features great road course racing. IndyCar is at Mid-Ohio Sunday at noon, partly sunny and 90 degrees at the green flag. Afterwards, the NASCAR guys are at Road America in Elkhart Lake, Wisconsin, partly sunny and a high of 82. This has been your race day weather, brought to you by B&W Plumbing, Heating, Cooling, and Drains, your independent American Standard heating and air conditioning dealer.
There's only one company that meets the gold standard in hair restoration and hair transplants. We Grow Hair Indy. Hey, it's JMV, and I'm here with Darren Andrews. Darren, people are coming from all over the world to We Grow Hair Indy to grow their hair back.
Hi, JMV. It's great to be here. Yes, they are. And JMV, as you know, we are very proud of the technology and the results at We Grow Hair Indy. We Grow Hair Indy is one of only two places in the entire US that offers both the Artist Robotic FUE and our trademark procedure, multi-unit hair grafting.
I was tired of my bald spot, which is why I went with multi-unit hair grafting and got more hair in one procedure. Call 888-724-5129 for a free evaluation. That's 888-724-5129, 888-724-5129, and grow your hair back. The one company that has the best technology and results. WeGrowHairIndy.com, the gold standard in hair restoration.
Hi guys, it's Andrew with Pine Grove Medical Clinic. Is erectile dysfunction damaging your relationship? Are you sick of the pill and all the side effects? Well, welcome to the future. We have a major medical breakthrough. Pine Grove Medical Clinic uses the most advanced form of wave therapy. Backed by 60 clinical studies, our technology uses pressure waves to repair and open up blood vessels. We've helped countless men get rid of their ED. But what is the true end result? Their relationship, even their lives, improve drastically. If you're ready to regain your love life, call us right now, and not only will the assessment and ultrasound be free, We'll also give you a gift that produces immediate results in the bedroom. It almost never fails. This is worth $550, and it's free to callers right now. 317-552-1111. That's 317-552-1111. Put a stop to your erectile dysfunction and experience what I call the happiness ripple effect. Call Pine Grove Medical Clinic now. 317-552-1111.
I'm Tom Shane. Growing up in a family of jewelers, I remember looking at gemstones alongside my father. I learned to appreciate their unique beauty and developed an eye for evaluating diamonds, rubies, and sapphires. To this day, I'm still examining gemstones. Throughout the year, I travel to Bangkok, the gemstone capital of the world, to hand-select only the most beautiful rubies and 16 colors of sapphires for Shane Company. When I'm there, I never select stones on a cloudy day. Only with natural sunlight can I accurately evaluate the color and the stone's brilliance. I also oversee the cutting of each stone to maximize its inherent beauty. That's why our gemstones are more beautiful and vibrant than any other jeweler's in town. Come in to find one that's perfect for you. Now you have a friend in the jewelry business, Shane Company and ShaneCo.com.
Hello, this is Richard Michalis with the Michalis Corporation. During this holiday, should you experience any water, storm, or fire damage and need our help, please contact us at 1-844-FIX-INDY. That's 1-844-FIX-INDY. Remember, water, storms, fire, and foundations, life happens. Michalis happens to help you through it.
Hey, it's Jake Query here. This Friday night, it's the craziest and wildest night of the year at Circle City Raceway. It's a wild and unpredictable school bus figure eight race, plus an insane demo derby, school bus rides, and spectator drags. Bring your street legal car out and compete to win $250. Circle City Raceway is at the Marion County Fairgrounds and is racing all weekend of the fair's final 3 days. Circle City Raceway at the Marion County Fairgrounds is family-friendly fun. For more info, check them out on Facebook at Circle City Raceway.
Rays, Red Sox, followed by the Mariners and the Padres. The coverage begins Monday at 1 on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
You're listening to Kevin and Query on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
Okay. By the way, Kevin, somebody just sent me a message.
What? Okay. Real American. What are we celebrating this weekend?
Independence Day.
That's right.
Which is, by the way, one of the cheesiest movies ever made that at the time people thought was cool.
That was one of like the first like adultish movies I was allowed to watch.
That's one of those movies you have to see in theaters. Like
the first 75% of it was good, and then it was like, okay.
I was just so happy to watch it. I
didn't even much.
I didn't even care.
Randy Quaid going into the alien ship that didn't do anything for you. I'm here, boys, or whatever he said.
I mean, come on. Somebody just asked, speaking of, this has nothing to do with Independence Day, but I guess it is a travel holiday. Hey, Jake, I just also surpassed 200,000 Speedy Reward points.
Boom.
I'm close to a million. I had enough for a gas refinery of my own like 6 months ago, and now it's back to two packs of gummy bears and a Mountain Dew.
So we're doing road trip up to my in-laws' lake house today. What do you guys think I should go with? Gardettos, combos?
Combos are the ultimate road trip food, Kevin.
Now, which one are you going with if you go combos?
I can be very content with just the regular.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, pretzel, nacho pretzel.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, I can think a little bit.
Pepperoni and cracker.
The box. The key is, you know, I'm hoping that maybe Maddie will be asleep so I can get the Gardettos and the combos and have a zero judgment ride.
Fair One enough. Hand in each bag and then using your knees to drive? Is that what we're
you
doing?
No, make sure you get a couple napkins. That's mm-hmm. a big thing at the gas station.
Now, let me ask sure you this, if you find
grab
this.
A couple of those.
You tell me if this. Did I already confess about my issue with the traveling urinal last time I had a road trip?
No, please tell us.
You know, I hate to say it, Jake, but boy, are we up against it.
No, I
quick segment here, right?
My cousin had bought me these like little traveling urinal things for exactly that. I guess the trucker's friend or something like that. And so when I was recently on a long solo road trip, I decided to use it, and I had a little bit of an extraction issue.
Yes, you did tell us this.
Okay, I did tell you this. And my boxers got a little bit wet, so I hung them out the window while I drove. Worked beautifully, actually.
We went from Ronald Nored and just the intelligence of him mm-hmm. and a bright young coach to go in there.
When I open the Quarry Gas and Gulp, it's going to be the only gas station on 69 between Bedford and Evansville. I've told you guys before, all we're going to have, fountain drinks, world's cleanest bathrooms like Bucky's, mm-hmm. Dip and combos, because that's all you need is combos.
God, Maddie's listening.
This segment sponsored by the Stinky Pinky Gas and Guzzle. Cheapest prices
me?
In the country because they water their gas down. Plus, if you're watching your figure, buy a gallon of Diet Coke for 89 cents.
What's
SEC
the name
Radio
of
came out for all of us.
Brian says he goes with
the Stinky
ranch.
Pinky Gas and Guzzle.
No. See,
what?
Kevin's wife is listening, Mark.
It's a sponsor. I'm just letting you know.
Brian goes, I always go with Ranch Bugles.
A gallon of Diet Coke for 89 cents.
I can only find at gas stations. I don't know if I've seen those.
What's that?
Ranch Bugles.
Oh, buddy. Ranch Bugles and then Caramel Bugles?
Caramel.
No.
Are you chasing one with the other? That could be a horrible combo. You'll be going to the Stinky Pinky Gas and Goes in no time flat.
Afterwards,
Trucker's friend number two, I think, is where you're at.
Afterwards, you get your flyer for the diabetes. Now, I'm telling you, the Caramel Bugles are unbelievable. You've not had those?
USC, UCLA to the
Holy
Big Ten.
Cow.
We'll get Aaron Torres, college football analyst, thoughts on that next here. Kevin Aquari, 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
If you know a volunteer who impacts your community, nominate them today to receive a year's worth of free vehicle maintenance. Just click the Do More tab at JiffyLubeIndiana.com.
America's leading internet provider just got even faster. Switch to Spectrum Internet, and you now get starting speeds of up to 300 megabits per second. Faster speeds for streaming, faster speeds for gaming, faster speeds for working or learning, all with 99.9% network reliability. So no matter what you do online, you can do it better, safer, and now even faster with Spectrum Internet. Visit Spectrum.com for details. Based on internet subscribers among top ISPs, speeds may vary. Restrictions apply.
When you're ready to trade up from ordinary to extraordinary, visit the Midwest's premier entertainment destination. Four Winds Casinos. Exceptional food, shows, shopping, and fun at Four Winds Casinos. With locations in South Bend, New Buffalo, Hartford, and Dowagiac. Visit FourWindsCasinos.com and trade up from ordinary to extraordinary. Four Winds Casinos.
Join Mark Patrick Seminars and lose the weight guaranteed. Only $49.99. Hypnosis to destroy unwanted cravings. Also, stop smoking with Mark Patrick. Lose your desire to smoke without cravings, irritability, weight gain, or your money back. Seminars Thursday, July 28th at the Hampton Inn & Suites in Fishers. Weight loss seminar 5:30 to 7:30 p.m. Stop smoking seminar 8 to 10 p.m. And Saturday, July 30th at the La Quinta Inn & Suites South in Indianapolis. Weight loss seminar 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Stop smoking seminar 2 to 4 p.m. Registration begins 30 minutes before seminar.
Charlie says sell it, so there's huge deals again this week at Payless Liquors. Southern Comfort 50 milliliter variety packs are only $4.69. Ready to drink 4 packs of Mom Water are $8.99. Crown Royal RTDs $12.99. Franzia Box Wine start at only $14.99. And 18 packs of Bud Light and Coors Light are $14.99 for the 12 ounce cans, $19.99 for the 16 ounces. And be sure to pick up some Evan Williams Black Label. The 1.75 liter bottle is only $22.99 at all 26 family owned Payless Liquor locations. Don't pay more, get more. Pay less at Payless Liquors.
93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
WIBC HD2, W298BB, WIBC HD3, W228CX, Indianapolis.
Cardinals, Phillies, Sunday Night Baseball. The coverage begins at 6 on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
You're listening to Kevin and Querry on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
Now, did you say that you're doing a road trip that's going to...
Not like a long road trip, but we'll certainly have one stop at a gas station. And boy, I feel like there's just nothing better than walking into the gas station and laying your eyes on the snack aisle and thinking, I deserve this for the effort I just put in and getting the vehicle to this point of the trip.
I would agree with that.
We've had some outrageous... text. What I say to you guys, limeade cherry Lays.
Now, have you had the...
What are we... I mean, what? Look at that thing. That thing looks awful.
Have you had the queso and cheese... Or queso and salsa ruffles?
Oh, no, but I'm... This sounds like something I would
like.
Yeah,
yeah. Oh, yeah.
So this is similar to your ketchup chips?
Blue and green bag. Probably better. Although, apparently, I'm going to Toronto now for IndyCar, so I can come back with all the ketchup chips you'd like.
Hallelujah. Boy,
you didn't like the ketchup chips, right?
They grew on me.
Mark, your thoughts on the ketchup?
They're solid. I like the smoked bacon better.
But again, I opened those Bucky Nuggets yesterday, and yet never saw them back.
Again, after the show, Jake said, here, you take them. So I did. Mark, and guess what? My wife and daughters chowed them down. I think I got two of them.
That was a silo. That was
three of them?
You were here. You left.
That wasn't even.
We never offered them.
That was a Santa Claus bag of Bucky's Nuggets.
And you should see these children go after snacks.
Now, what?
Evens.
I guess.
What should be the Big Ten welcoming gift for USC and UCLA?
Oh, it's got to be.
Half of Jake's Speedway points.
Corn nuts?
They show up to their first Big Ten meetings in Chicago, and they get what?
Isotoner gloves? A scarf?
Gift card to REI so they can bundle up.
Here's an ice melter for your first, late November road trip to play at Wisconsin.
Yeah, I mean...
For your plane on the way.
Honestly, they should just get, gift cards to a Pilot truck stop. They don't necessarily have those in Southern California, in Beverly Hills, you know what I mean?
Our next guest on the Payless Liquors hotline.
Thrilled to be joining this conversation, yeah, boy, I'm sure.
I'm sure. Mark, you said he's waking up very early with us. Aaron Torres from Fox Sports Radio. Aaron, for our listeners out there, where are you calling in from right now?
Well, you guys called me, and I am in Pasadena, California, about 10 minutes from the Rose Bowl, where the Indianapolis Hoosiers are opening the 2024 season. Did I just break news right there, or what?
Indianapolis Hoosiers.
See, it is still 6 a.m. here.
6:05 in the morning, and Aaron Torres is calling in for us. Aaron, I saw yesterday you mentioned on Twitter a bad day for college sports. Could you expand on that?
Well, whenever any of these moves get made, and, I'm old enough, I'm actually from Connecticut originally, so, I'm a UConn guy, and I remember when the old Big East broke up, and when Rutgers left, when Boston College left the Big East for the ACC, it was over money 20 years ago, and we understand that this is about dollars and cents, but I just think this just brings us, either A, one step closer to, super conferences where we're talking two or three, 2022, 2024 team conglomerates, or, I also think it just sets up a world where the ACC or the SEC, excuse me, and the Big Ten just have significant financial advantages over everybody else, and maybe both conferences do stay at 16 teams. And so, I just think that when I say it's a sad day, what I mean is that, a lot of the things that I think we all love about college sports, the regionality of it, the arguments over, in the old days it was the Big Ten versus the Pac-12, or is the SEC really that good, or how would this team do in that league? I think a lot of those arguments and a lot of what makes college sports so great, I think are starting to get lost. And is this the last move for the Big Ten for a while? It might be, because who knows if any of these other schools out there, Oregon, Washington, whatever, have any actual value to them or their TV partners. But, I don't think two conferences where everybody has a significant advantage over the rest of the sport is good. I don't think 24 or 32 or 30 team super leagues is good. But it feels as though we're headed towards one of those two things, and I don't think it's good for the health and enjoyment of college football and college sports overall.
Okay, so let me, and I don't disagree with any of that, Aaron, let me ask you this question. Yesterday I see UCLA and USC joining the Big Ten, and I think to myself, well, that seems like it's going to be a logistical nightmare for the rowing team of UCLA.
Yeah.
And then somebody said, you know what, though, man? It's not like their Big Ten games are all going to be strictly against the closest Western opponent of Nebraska, because by the time it's all said and done, Arizona, Arizona State, Washington, Oregon are all going to join, and then we're going to have this super conference of East and West. Fair statement?
I think there's two ways to look at it. I think to your point, I think it only logistically makes sense, right? I mean, if you stay with 16 teams and you have two that are just major geographical outliers, so, you know, so, literally 3,000 miles from some of its quote unquote, you know, conference members and conference rivals, like, I don't think that that really makes sense. But then I also sit back and I look and I go back to last year, guys, and I remember when Texas and Oklahoma went to the SEC, and everybody said, well, what's the Big 12's, what's the Big 10's counter move, and what's, you know, who's going to take who from the Big 12, and is the Pac-12 going to grab this school and that school, and is the Big 10 going to take Kansas for basketball? And frankly, you know, the Pac-12 maybe should have tried to do something. They didn't. You know, that looks kind of dumb today. But the reason that none of those moves happened was because Iowa State and Kansas, as good as their basketball program are, they didn't really change the value of the TV contract that the Big Ten was trying to negotiate with its TV partners. And so I think on the one hand, I do think logistically it makes sense at some point to add some Western teams for the exact reason that you mentioned. I mean, that's the sad part about all this. Is there a way that we could have done something with football, you know, on a national level that didn't impact all of these other Olympic sports? But then on the flip side, I do wonder, are those teams, is Oregon as great as that brand is Washington as great as that brand has been historically? Does it move the needle with the TV partners? That I don't know. I'm not, you know, unfortunately privy enough to those high level meetings, but if they don't, then I do think there's a world where the Pac-12 is forced to move on without, you could argue, it's two flagship programs. And that I think is obviously the interesting next domino. Is it sounds great on paper to add more schools, but every decision is being made off of TV money. And I don't know if those schools necessarily add TV value or add value to the next TV contract.
Again, he's Aaron Torres with us. You can find him on Twitter at @Aaron_Torres, host on Fox Sports Radio. And again, here with us just 10 minutes away from Pasadena. That aspect I find interesting, Aaron. Fans of USC, fans of UCLA, what have you heard from them in the last 24 hours? Are they thrilled for noon Eastern kickoffs and 7 p.m. Tuesday night basketball games?
Well, it's interesting. You know, I think it's weird in Pac-12 country. Everyone that I've talked to and spoken to and even friends, you know, not even people in our business or people that work at these schools, I think there's two kind of you know, thoughts. Is like, I think everybody gets why this is done, right? And like, I don't watch the show Survivor, right? Like, this is college sports is the show Survivor right now. It's you're either part of the in club and you're going to be making money hand over fist, or you're not. And you know, the parallels honestly between Texas and Oklahoma last year are like jarring to me, in the sense that everybody was bummed that it happened, but everybody also realized why it happened. And so it was funny to even kind of survey, you know, friends that are Arizona alums or Arizona State fans or whatever, where you know, where they were sitting there saying, this sucks. I mean, this really sucks, and I'm worried about the future of my athletic department, but I'd be lying if I said I blame USC and UCLA, because it is about dollars and cents. And I think the other thing, it's very interesting, I hadn't really thought of it until I started talking to other people, is that, you know, this was really something that had been in the works, not just over the last couple weeks, but really was probably put into place with this awful TV contract that these schools have been under over the past decade and change, the failure of the Pac-12 network under Larry Scott. I think that was a lot of the takeaway and pushback I got too, is that this conference has been so mismanaged that I don't blame anybody for wanting to get out of it. And so, you know, I would guess that probably, you know, outside of this footprint, I think there's probably a lot of people that are probably thinking that Oregon fans and Arizona fans or whatever are laughing or mocking or on the other side, angry at UCLA and USC, and that isn't the vibe that I've gotten at all. I think there's obviously a disappointment, you know, for non-USC UCLA fans about the news. I think there's a fear among the 10 other schools about what's next for them. But I don't think there's like anger towards USC and UCLA, because I think they all know that if their school was in a similar position, their school probably would have and should have made the same decision that USC and UCLA have.
Aaron, are you still it's 6:15 in the morning where you are, and you're very knowledgeable and energetic here. Do you still live on East Coast time?
You know, I pretty much do. I try to get up pretty early. And I try to get, I'm going to get a workout in right after you. I'm actually hosting radio this afternoon, which is part of the reason why I'm up early today. I'm up at this time pretty much every day. And then here's the other thing. I heard you guys talking about your wives and kids and they're stealing your chips and all that stuff. You know, my wife's got a job too. And you know, she's got to get up. And so listen, I mean, I know, I know some people in our business in the sports media get, you know, labeled as lazy, or we sleep all day, or we wake up at 2 in the afternoon.
Talk to my partner, Aaron, Jake.
she's got to get up and get stuff done. And so I'm sitting there saying, well, I might as well get up too. And, but yes, I do very much, you know, part of it is I'm from the East Coast. I also, just with the news cycle, I tend to be up pretty early. So I'll say this, guys, as much as I've enjoyed this, and I'm happy to continue talking as long as you want, I would have been up at this time with or without the phone call from Indianapolis.
Well, that's impressive. And so here's the thing. I feel like a lot of where we are right now with this conversation is the fact that the Pac-12 hit the snooze alarm too many times.
And
big part of that is... So which of the – I'm going to give you two things, Aaron, and you tell me which one more led to where we are right now. The first is that the Pac-12 kind of slept on bringing Texas in when they had the opportunity, which would have been the first domino in that side of it. The other is that once name, image, likeness became – and transitioned from, hey, kids can be able to do a deal for Pizza Hut, into Miami just signed a quarterback for $9.5 million, that then these teams just said, you know what, Kate, like the lid's blown off this whole thing, to hell with it. We're becoming semi-pro ball, and let's go. Let's just join everybody together. Which one more brought us to this point?
Is this just for USC and UCLA, or just kind of the state of cover?
Yeah, I mean, because UCLA and USC are big time dominoes, because this is the first totally non-regional alignment that we've seen.
No, I think it's a combination of both. I mean, look, obviously, look, if in 2010 or whatever it was, Texas and Oklahoma and all those schools had come to the Pac-12 and become the Pac-16, then we're living in a totally different world right now. But listen, I think it is very much about dollars and cents. The report, I think Brett McMurphy had it, was that the money will be double what they would have gotten with the new Pac-12 deal. And I don't think NIL, I don't think you can sleep on that. It was actually really, I guess, ironic now. I was talking to an assistant coach in basketball, and we were talking the other day, this was before this news came, about how Lincoln Riley's impact on the entire Pac-12, or the impact that it would have, is if, you know, in the world that we lived in 2 days ago, where we still have a 4-team playoff and the Pac-12 is going on as 12 teams, you know, if USC elevates itself to the level that we all think that it can get to under Lincoln Riley, then me and my buddy were sitting there saying, like, you know, that's more money for the conference in TV revenue. It's more money, you know, by appearing in the college football playoff, which trickles down to all of these schools, which leads to better facilities, better assistant coaches. Oh, by the way, more money in the NIL pot. And I do think that last part, I don't think you can undersell. You know, UCLA, their defense wasn't even good last year. The football team, you know, two starters ended up in the portal and ended up at Miami. I am not accusing Miami of anything, but I think we all read the reports about what happened at Miami. And you go from a really good school at UCLA to Miami, and you can assume that there was probably some NIL promises that was made either prior to those kids deciding to leave or the second that they entered the portal. And so I think it really goes back to the dollars and cents of it all. You know, protecting your school, but also, again, exactly what you just said, in this new world of NIL, that's another revenue stream that you have to have. And you know, one thing I'll say is, like, I love living on the West Coast. I love being here. I think there's a lot of things that are underrated about the teams and the programs out here. But, you know, you were going to fall behind in NIL if you stayed in the Pac-12. And that is another thing that is another thing that you now have to account for. It's not just facilities, not just donations, it's not just this, it's not just that. And lastly, I would say, you know, on top of all that, I do wonder, you know, I think we're all thinking about the negatives today, and I'm one of them. I said it was a sad day for college sports yesterday, but I do wonder, like as weird as it sounds, when UCLA, they don't draw great at the Rose Bowl 10 minutes from where I'm standing right now. I think, as weird
they're
as
about
sounds,
to.
That's what I was going to say.
Half of Indiana is going to go out there when Indiana goes, right?
That's exactly what I was going to say. And I think, you know, it's easy for all of us to look at the negatives. I don't think it's good for college sports. But I think the more that I think about it, whether it is UCLA, USC, it really is going to be, you know, a financial gain. As you said, you know, everybody's going to want to make that road trip for football. Oh, by the way, you know, Wisconsin and Michigan and Penn State and Ohio State, I can't speak to Indiana, have huge alumni bases on the West Coast. And so, you know, I'm not saying that I'm happy about it, but when I thought about it more and I talked to some people that were at those respective schools yesterday, like, they were excited. Like, I thought they were going to be bummed, and we got all these long road trips. And as you guys were saying, you know, Minnesota in December, like, nobody's looking forward to that. They were jacked up about
it. Well, the other side of it, though, Aaron, I was curious, do you think, you live out there, so you would know this, okay?
Sure.
Listen, for a kid that is a basketball player, I mean, if I'm a recruit, and I've got an opportunity now to play in the, if I'm choosing between Minnesota and Creighton, I'm like, hey, I want to play for Minnesota because I want to go and play in Pauley. I want to go out to L.A., you know, whatever. If I'm a football player from Sherman Oaks, California, and I'm choosing between UCLA and another school, San Diego State, is it possible that UCLA's recruiting now, though, could be hurt because guys are going to be like, look, I don't want to make 4.5-hour flights to go play in 30-degree temperatures in football. I just don't. Could it hurt UCLA and USC?
I think it could. I think the other factor that we have to factor in, and it sounds weird and it might only be once or twice a year, but what you just said, I mean, you're also going to have to play in 20-degree weather in December, potentially with a playoff berth on the line, although who knows what the playoff will look like 2, 5, 10 years from now. But that's the other factor, is you're probably going to have to play 2 road games post-November 1st in Michigan, Pennsylvania, whatever. And I think that's a factor too. But no, I think what I would say is I was surprised. I think that the people at USC and UCLA were more excited than I was expecting yesterday. But what I would also say, this decision is no different than any other decision that gets made really in life, but also in college sports, right? We all hailed NIL last year as the greatest thing ever. I think it's been a net positive for college sports, but there have been side effects that we just talked about. The transfer portal, we all hailed it as a positive for college sports. There are side effects that we didn't maybe see at the time. And it's going to be the same with this. I think we do see some of the negatives, but I'm sure there's going to be other negatives that we don't see. I think recruiting could be hurt. I think, you know, fan engagement, I think, will be interesting to follow. Is it a positive? Is it a negative after that first trip for Indiana fans, first trip for Wisconsin fans, whatever? So, you know, it's just a crazy story, guys. I mean, to wake up yesterday having no idea it was going to happen and to wake up today and it just being done is just insane. And I don't know what else to say. I really don't.
Aaron, last one. Any earthly idea what the college football playoff is going to look like? Or should look like?
You know, well, what it probably should be is just the Big Ten playing a Final Four, you know, basically make a Big Ten Final Four, a SEC Final Four, and let the champions play, basically, at this point, is probably what you should do. And
so no Clemson, no Oregon, no Notre Dame?
That's what I was going to say. See how Clemson is in any given year. I mean, it's not what's going to happen. But, you know, first of all, my main thought is, I mean, how do those five commissioners get in a room? It's going to happen, right? But, like, it's just, you know, and I think this goes back to my initial point of it's a sad day for college sports. It's just such a, like, at the most surface level, it's just greedy and gross when you just think about, one, what Greg Sankey did to Bob Bowlesby, the Big 12 commissioner last year. And now when you think about what Kevin Warren did walking into that alliance meeting with George Kliakoff, the new, not new anymore, but the year old Pac-12 commissioner, the new ACC commissioner, and we supposedly had this alliance where we're going to stand up to the big bad SEC and we're going to throw around our power, and now you stab them in the back a year later. I think it's kind of gross. I don't know what it means for the college football playoff, but, you know, good luck getting those five to agree on anything with the climate of everything that's happened over the last year and change. So,
Aaron, last thing from me, and then we'll let you go. This is a simple one-word, one-letter answer, okay? I'm back in school right now. I'm actually finishing my degree at Indiana so that I can get on the alumni trip to Pasadena.
Congratulations.
Thank you. I should have probably done that 25 years ago, right? So I'm going to give to you a tweet that I sent yesterday, and I want you to grade A to F.
Okay.
The absurdity of it. A being not absurd at all, very dialed in. F being totally absurd. Go join QAnon, okay? Here we go.
Sure.
I said, here is my 2028 prediction. The Big Ten East will be Ohio State, Michigan, Illinois, Michigan State, Purdue, Indiana, Northwestern, Maryland, Rutgers, Penn State, and Minnesota. The Big Ten West will be UCLA, USC, Arizona, Arizona State, Oregon, Washington, Wisconsin, Nebraska, Colorado, Utah, and Iowa.
Wow. So that would be, what, 24 total teams?
Yep.
I mean, I don't think it's crazy. I can't listen. We went to 14 teams in the SEC a decade ago, and everything, we're perfectly happy here. Then we went to 16 last summer, and Greg Sankey said he's perfectly happy there. Then the Pac-12 said we're perfectly happy at four, or the Big Ten, excuse me, we're happy at 14. There's nobody else that moves the needle for us. This stuff, it's never ending, right? Every time, listen, last summer, Bob Bowlesby at Big 12 Media Day said, I think realignment is done for the foreseeable future. A week later, Texas and Oklahoma leave. The Pac-12 commissioner at some point over the last month has said, I think conference realignment is over. USC and UCLA leave. So the idea that everyone's going to remain static, I just don't buy it. And so, oh, by the way, here's the other thing. It might not be the Pac-12's move. It might be the SEC adding schools and then Big 10 move. It could be the SEC deciding we want to add Florida State, Miami, XYZ, whoever, and the Pac-12 feels like they then have to add somebody to keep up. So I don't think it's crazy at all. And I know you asked for a one letter. I'll give it an A-. I don't think it's crazy at all. I don't think necessarily the Big Ten is waking up today saying, how do we get Oregon and Washington and XYZ? But I don't think – it's not going to end here because it never ends. I think whatever radio show you guys are doing in 2050, we'll be talking about some weird realignment thing, because ever since I've started following college sports, it's just one 5-year cycle after another. So I give it an A-. I don't think it's crazy at all.
I think it's just massive right now for college sports in general to get some rules and regulations in place. I agree. And I say that for conference realignment, NIL, transfer rules, you need your fans to know what a little bit of rules semblance to it is. And I think like the CBA and the NFL or the NBA, I think that is a must right now in college athletics. Aaron, thanks a bunch for waking up with us. I know you would have been up anyways, but for coming on the show, and good luck today with your own.
All right. Thank you, guys. Appreciate you. Have a great afternoon. Thank you.
At Aaron Torres on Twitter, again, _ in there, Fox Sports Radio. Jake, one thing that I do think is a big bummer with all of this, I kind of enjoy, whether it's a bowl game or an NCAA tournament game, or certainly in the non-conference part, like, you know, Oregon coming to play at Ohio State last year. Like, that's a really kind of fun atmosphere for me of like, oh, wow, I want to see what Oregon looks like. You know, I don't get to watch a lot of these Pac-12 schools. You know, the Big 12, you know, air raid this, and they put up 60, 70 points a game. Like, oh, yeah, I want to watch a Big 12 game because you kind of know what their niche is. Right. You kind of know what their stereotype is. This loses some of that. I mean, yeah, USC and UCLA are still going to primarily have Southern California kids in their team. But I think when you get to just two power conferences, you lose a little bit of the 5 or 6 regions of the country.
Can you imagine, though, two guys in Santa Monica? Like, yeah, man, I got tickets for the Bruins tomorrow out at the Rose Bowl. Like, I was thinking it's supposed to be 72 and sunny again. You want to go? Awesome, dude. That's pretty cool. Who are they playing? Rutgers. Really? Okay.
Don't you love how everything is Rutgers?
Yeah, Rutgers is Rutgers is the punchline of the Big Ten, right?
Let's not act like the two football teams in this state have done a whole lot over the last few years.
That's true.
Come on, I guess Purdue did have a nice season last year, but yeah, Rutgers seems to be the punchline.
Yeah, man, I went yesterday to like see USC, and it was awesome. But like, what is that LEO thing that other dude was talking about?
Yeah.
What is that, man? They were playing like University of Indiana or something.
I think
like,
they mean REO, like Speedwagon.
That Indiana coach just needs to hit the ball a few times to kind of calm down.
That
on the
guy
sideline.
Needs to. He's way overhyped, man.
I will say this again. USC and UCLA, their last 4 years of playing football, so that would be 8 combined seasons. Jake, they've had more than 5 wins in 2 of those 8 seasons.
I'm telling you, though, man.
More than 5 wins.
Which is staggering, because you take one step out of the – I mean, I'm telling you, like, Tom Brady, if he stepped on the UCLA campus tomorrow, would be like, I might just go back to school and play here. I mean, it's unbelievable.
Charlie Clifford, Santa Monica Jake needs to become a reoccurring bit. Charlie, just stop. No. The ego does not need to be fed, especially on a Friday in the 9 o'clock.
It's pretty awesome, dude.
Pop quiz is coming up. Scotty's entered the building here. Scotty, the pop quiz.
Those dudes are wearing candy striped pants at Poly, man. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, pop quiz looks impossible. It is Freebie Friday, though. Jiffy Lube prize pack coming your way no matter win or loss. Let's hit a morning checkdown.
The morning checkdown.
Omaha!
Brought to you by QC Kinetics. Relieving your joint pain at QCKinetics.com on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
NBA free agency got underway last night, 6 o'clock. One of the first names to sign, Gary Payton II, signing with the Portland Trailblazers. Not a huge bit of news there, but there were some big names that signed. Problem is they all signed basically where they already were. John Morant staying in Memphis, no surprise. The MVP, Nikola Jokic, staying in Denver. Karl Anthony Towns staying in Minnesota. Those names that were of note, Jalen Brunson going with a four-year, $104 million deal with the New York Knicks. That's Kyle ridiculous. Anderson was Good a little grief. Bit. I know, it is amazing.
The Knicks. Yeah, Julius Randle, Jalen Brunson, they're going to lead us.
Yeah, to a sixth seed. Yeah. Woo.
Yeah, man, it's kind of like seeing Rutgers at Poly, right?
Kyle Anderson. The show is 3 hours. This voice elongates things.
Kyle Anderson, like 2 years.
You got Kyle Anderson does play like how your voice sounds.
He got like $18 million. It's pretty cool for the Timberwolves. Gary I'm doing Harris, a little bit of willpower there, too, by the way.
Gary Harris, 2-for-26 from Orlando. Victor Oladipo, 1-for-11 to stay in Miami there. Thaddeus Young. 2 years, $16 million. 34 years old with the Raptors. It's a good fit, I think. Thad with those young guys.
Chris Boucher, 3 years, $32.5 million to Toronto. Not bad for the former water boy from Louisiana, right?
And again,
big-time bucks.
Pacers tag along with Kevin Durant. Find the third team there in that trade. I still think they can do something effective.
Major League Baseball yesterday. Phillies over the Braves, 14-4. It was the Pirates over the Brewers, 8-7. Dodgers over the Pods, 3-1. Cleveland over Minnesota, 5-3. Houston continues to be kind of a pain to New York, seemingly the only team that could beat the Yankees. They beat them 2-1. Indianapolis Indians, 4-3 winners over the Nashville Sounds. And yes, in fact, couldn't help yourself, could you, Mark?
Jake, continue with your voice.
Nice piece of hitting. That dude,
that's Patrick Wisdom, man. Like,
what do you got for Willie Harris?
I was
Harris?
Hoping they'd have him extracted.
Third round of Wimbledon is underway.
We got another highlight.
Farmer goes. Pitches got eight American men.
We need to have a meeting about this.
Final 32.
Strike
that's the first
out,
time since 1997 that the American men have had at least eight in the round of 32.
You sounded like Tom Brenneman right there. Despite the highlights, you just kept going, right?
Well, boy, that's probably the only time I want to be compared to old the Thumb. So say, thank you for that one.
That's the best nothing company like to keep right there.
Jake, Mid-Ohio for you this weekend?
Mid-Ohio sports car course indeed for Indy cars. A matter of fact, Sunday is when the race gets underway. You can hear it here at noon. Our coverage begins for IndyCar and the IMS Radio Network right here on The Fan. Elsewhere in racing, in Formula One, it is at Silverstone. That is the British Grand Prix. That's right. Racing. Sunday at 10.
Oh, my God. We're doing this all week next week?
Next week, it's nothing but Brits and Bama all week with Kevin gone. British Grand Prix, Sunday, 10 o'clock. NASCAR is going to be at Road America, the four-mile road course up in Wisconsin. That race Sunday at 3 o'clock. And don't forget, if you're not wanting to wait until Sunday for racing, and I don't blame you, why would you want to? Racing's going to be taking place Friday night, that is correct, tonight. The craziest and wild night of the year is tonight at Circle City Raceway. You're talking about on dirt, the wild and unpredictable school bus figure eight race, plus an insane demo derby, school bus rides, and spectator drags. Bring a street legal car out tonight, compete to win $250 at Circle City Raceway on dirt, the Marion County Fairgrounds. It's the end of the fair, and guess what? They're going to be racing all 3 days for it. For more information, look on Facebook for Circle City Raceway. Then tomorrow night, Tom Wood Group, Indianapolis Speedrome, powered by Lincoln Tech. It's autograph night. You can come out and meet the drivers for the Indianapolis Speedrome. See the cars up close and personal. Unbelievable access. And it's a great family environment for the kids to be able to come out, watch racing, including the figure eight cars, which run that wild and unpredictable 75-lap figure eight race on Saturday. That's tomorrow night. Family-friendly racing action, great food, free parking, and outrageous fun. That's everything that you get at the Indianapolis Speedrome at the corner of Kittley and Brookville on Indy's southeast side. You can find all the information at speeddrome.com. By the way, Jiffy Lube is going to be giving away an oil change. That's because it's a freebie Friday for the pop quiz. We would love for you to participate. Do so next. 239-1070. Mark, why are you shaking your head?
Them California boys going to be more lost than Lane Kiffin doing basic math when they get to the Midwest.
That's right.
Hey, it's Jake Query. This Saturday night, it's Indy's loudest and wildest fireworks show, plus late model figure eight action at the Indianapolis Speedrome. Times, tickets, and more at speedrome.com.
Dan Dockich's annual Tom Dockich Memorial Golf Outing, presented by Franciscan Health, is on the schedule and set for July 18th. Go to 1075thefan.com/events for details and tickets.
At Family Dollar, we know you want more for your summer. Find everything from grilling supplies and beach toys to deals on your favorite soft drinks. Family Dollar, helping you do more.
Response to Diamonds Direct's amazing finance offer has been off the chart, so we're extending it through this Saturday. You can go into the holiday weekend with some new bling and spread your payments over 5 years with zero interest. Rings, earrings, bands, bracelets, colored gemstones. Pick any item, pay nothing down, and enjoy 5 years zero interest financing. It's the best and smartest way to buy, but you can't wait any longer. This special offer ends this Saturday and will not be extended again. Only at Diamonds Direct. Details and more at DiamondsDirect.com. Unapproved credit.
Hey, Indiana, baseball season is in full swing, and there's no better place to bet on America's pastime than on America's number one sportsbook, FanDuel Sportsbook. Hey, it's Mark from Kevin and Query. Right now, new customers get $150 in free bets guaranteed when you place your first $5 bet. All you have to do is sign up with promo code MARK to get in on the action. FanDuel lets you bet the money line, home run props, strike totals, and so much more. Plus, you can combine your bets for an even bigger payday with the same game parlay. If you haven't tried FanDuel, now's the perfect time to give it a shot. Just sign up with promo code MARK and turn a $5 bet into $150 in free bets, win or lose. Now, I bet the Cubs against the Reds yesterday. Needless to say, that bet hit very easily. Promo code MARK exclusively on the FanDuel Sportsbook app. Also, opt in Independence Day of Dingers from today to July 4th. A $25 bet on a same-game parlay gets you $5 in free bets for every home run hit in that game. Check it out today. Again, promo code MARK on the FanDuel Sportsbook app, M-A-R-C. Must be 21 and over in Indiana. First online real money wager only. $10 first deposit required. Bonus issued is non-withdrawable free bets that expire 14 days after receipt. See full terms at FanDuel.com/sportsbook. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-9-WITH-IT.
Terry Stacey with your American Standard Race Day weather, brought to you by B&W Plumbing, Heating, Cooling, and Drains. Independence Weekend features great road course racing. IndyCar is at Mid-Ohio Sunday at noon, partly sunny and 90 degrees at the green flag. Afterwards, the NASCAR guys are at Road America in Elkhart Lake, Wisconsin. Partly sunny and a high of 82. This has been your race day weather, brought to you by B&W Plumbing, Heating, Cooling, and Drains, your independent American Standard heating and air conditioning dealer.
Dan Dockich here. Before you grab your clubs and head to the course this summer, learn the ABCD signs of melanoma. Irregular borders or uneven colors on moles, get them checked out. If you've already been diagnosed with melanoma, call for a second opinion. Franciscan Health provides a comprehensive approach to treating melanoma with their team of oncologists, melanoma surgeons, and dedicated nurse navigator. So you're not going at it alone. Download their guide at franciscanhealth.org/cancercare today.
Hi, I'm Ryan Kelly with thehomeloanexpert.com. Mortgage interest rates have started to drop, but you need to get locked in today. And at thehomeloanexpert.com, our rates are over a quarter point lower than the national average. We don't just talk about low rates, we have them. Maybe you've been holding off on that cash out refinance. Don't wait any longer. Now's the time. Visit thehomeloanexpert.com. Home of the 10-day closing guarantee.
The Home Loan Expert LLC, NMLS number 1326241.
School is in session.
Scott Drew, how do you like Kendall Brown?
I know Pacer fans will like him, and why I say that is because you like guys of high character, you like great teammates, but you like guys who know how to play. He can guard 1 through 5. He can cut as well as anyone in the league. What'll take him to the next level is, can he shoot 40% plus from 3? The spacing rules help someone with his athleticism.
Dan Dockich, weekdays noon to 3 on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan. Have you studied? Can you handle the pressure? Sharpen your pencils. It's time for the Pop Quiz with Kevin and Query. Brought to you by Jiffy Lube, Indiana's favorite oil change since 1985.
Now, every once in a while, I've decided to mix things up here and make it fun. Every once in a while, I come up with a trivia question that randomly pops into my head as I'm pulling into the parking garage in the morning. And I think to myself, I'm going to ask Scotty that trivia question. You know, Scotty's Mr. Smarty Pants over there. He comes up with the questions and everything. So Today, I'm going to present Scotty with a question. I'm going to allow him the opportunity during the pop quiz while we're doing our dog and pony show here to come up with an answer at the top of his head. And then we're going to ask Scotty if he can come up with the answer by the time we're done with the pop quiz. Are you ready for this one?
Okay.
This actually came to me courtesy of Texans Mark. He asked me this one the other day, and I thought that's a really good question. The 1996 NBA draft, the players selected with the first pick in the first round and the first pick in the second round came from the same college. Name the two players. So we'll let Scotty stew on that and everybody else while we go through the pop quiz.
Someone was asking me before we get to the pop quiz, Jake, the number TV contract-wise that Big Ten schools are expecting to take home with this next TV deal. Have you seen that yet?
I have not. I thought I heard... I don't even want to say because it's probably so off base.
100 million?
I heard 70 million annually.
Yeah. I thought I read at least 80.
Yeah.
And someone was asking why. Well, I think you're involving all those markets, LA, Chicago, a little bit on the East Coast as well. And then, of course, the teams. I mean, Big Ten country already. People are obsessed with college football. And I think Fox and the Big Ten Networking Company will be willing to shelve that out.
Man, it's righteous bucks. That's my Spicoli. See, now we're onto that now.
All right, pop quiz time is here. Have 20 minutes left, Kevin. 20 minutes left.
It's Friday. Come on.
Number one through eight.
We'll go with number one since I asked Scotty that question about the first player picked in the two respective rounds of 96.
Mark, who we got?
Mark number one.
Ooh, yesterday we had two mics.
I know. Two mics yesterday, two Marks today.
What's up, Mark?
Hey, what's up? What's up, guys? Hey, Jake, you're not drinking already, are you?
Boy, tell me about it, right?
Why would you say that, Mark?
I was just a hunch.
Mark, you sound like a nice fellow, though. And first off, are you next to Jim Irsay's Learjet?
No, I wish.
Are you at work?
No, not yet. No, I just I've clean office buildings, just the hospital buildings, and
we've talked before, correct?
No,
we've not.
No. I've called in, but not for the pop quiz.
What made you call in today?
I just clicked it on. I was about 10 minutes early and just called in.
Now, Mark, are you a native to Indianapolis?
Oh yeah, Southside, Paramaridian, 1990.
He listened to the last 10 minutes and said, "I need to call into this show."
You
That's
imagine?
Amazing.
Herb Dove, right?
Herbie Dove, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Fly Falcons, fly for Perry Meridian.
Isaac Booth went to Cal, and then he went to play with Ray Lewis in Baltimore, Cleveland. Yep,
that's pretty cool. Yeah. Perry's funny, man. I went to North Central in '91, so I'm a year behind you. But I had a buddy in college that dated a girl from Perry Meridian. Other than that, I didn't have a lot of interaction with Perry Meridian people. But everybody's pretty cool that I meet from Perry Meridian.
I didn't know her. I didn't know her.
Mark, well, why would
first name's Gina? I won't say the last name.
I don't know if Perry Meridian is still this way, but why were they so good at wrestling there for a while?
Big guys. I wasn't into wrestling.
Okay, Mark didn't know wrestlers.
No, big guys. Well, I mean, you can have little guys and be good at wrestling
didn't
as well.
Know but yeah. Gina.
All right, Mark. Well, let's see how you do on the pop quiz. It's certainly a middle finger to end the week from Scotty.
That's good.
All right. That's all right.
Mark, would you like for me, that would be Jake, to lead you off with questions 1, 3, and 5, or would you like for Kevin to lead you off with that trio?
You go ahead, buddy.
All right. Michael Perez hit 3 home runs for the Pittsburgh Pirates last night in their win over the Brewers. Brian Reynolds homered 3 times for Pittsburgh on Wednesday. Jack Sawinski hit 3 home runs on June 19th. Name the last major league team to have 3 different players record 3 homer games in the same month. A, the 61 Yankees, B, the 2019 Twins, C, the 97 Mariners, or D, this is actually the first time it's ever happened.
I'd say D.
Okay.
Number 2, Patrick Wisdom had a big night as the Cubs beat the Reds 15-7 last night.
It's drilled out towards left center.
Come on, man.
I do feel like Tom Brennan again. Wisdom is just the second Cub to hit a pair of home runs, drove in 6 runs, and steal a base since the RBI became an official stat in 1920. Name the other Cub with 2 homers, 6 RBIs, and a stolen base in the same game. A, Andre Dawson. B, Ryan Sandberg. C, Tuffy Rhodes. Or D, Phil Cavaretta.
Here's your hint.
Ah!
That's your hint.
What was the first one again?
Andre Dawson.
Trey Young. Dominique Wilkins.
The Hawk. Andre Dawson.
All right, question number three. Which team currently leads the major league in wins where it scored the winning run in its final turn at bat? Was it the Yankees, the Twins, the Guardians, or the Astros? Give me a hint. They changed names recently.
I'll tell you, Guardians.
Okay.
Spoon feeding Mark here on this Friday morning. Mark, today marks the 112th anniversary of Old Comiskey Park opening in Chicago. How many World Series were held at Old Comiskey? 2, 3, 4, or 5?
We'll go 3.
Three, okay. Last question here, question number 5. On this day in 1904, the first Summer Olympic Games to be held in the United States opened. Where did the 1904 Summer Olympics take place? They had a World Fair around the same time that debuted the ice cream cone, as a matter of fact. Was it Chicago, St. Louis, Atlanta, or Los Angeles? A little hint, it is the one place besides Indianapolis where Jake Query was once a sportscaster. Chicago, St. Louis, Atlanta, or Los Angeles?
Go St. Louis.
Okay.
All right, let's see how Mark did. We've got a little bit of Pacers news, nothing crazy. We'll touch on after the pop quiz. Number one, Michael Perez, 3 homers for the Pirates in their win over the Brewers last night. A lot of other stuff in that question. Basically, the Pirates are first to do it.
Did he say B or D on that one?
He said D.
Yeah, did he say D?
Okay. Yes!
Andre Dawson was the correct answer for question number 2.
Yes! Who holds the major league lead right now and wins where it scored the winning run in the final at bat? Indeed, the Guardians.
Yeah.
Question number 4, he went with 3. He did get St. Louis right, but for question number 4, the correct answer was 4. Stay on the line, though. It's Freebie Friday, Mark. Now, Scotty.
You don't get to come back tomorrow.
Come over here and get on the microphone, Scotty. We're going to do this on Fridays, I guess. I'll give Scotty a question. 1996. First overall pick in the NBA draft of round 1 and the first pick of round 2 were college teammates. Who were they?
Well, I know Iverson was number 1. I'm trying to think of who would have gone first in the second round. Was it a center?
At the very least, a power forward. Yes.
I'd call him a big dude. Great name. Yes,
sir. Harrington?
Who's that?
Othello Harrington?
Scotty is correct.
Scotty J.
Allen Iverson and Othella Harrington.
Scotty, good work there.
Nicely done.
Good work. Ricky Rubio back to the Cavs. So do the Pacers get absolutely nothing out of Ricky Rubio?
Cap space? Did they get cap space out of that?
But did they? Did they use that cap space, I guess, would be the better question. 3-year, $18 million deal, Ricky Rubio back to the Cavs. I mean, they didn't use that cap space for anything, right?
Yeah, I think that's right.
Seems rather worthless.
And I can't recall, they got Rubio in which deal?
That was the Caris LeVert to Cleveland.
I mean, I guess that would be your answer. Like, they needed to facilitate, from a cap standpoint, probably make things match, which is why they took on Rubio.
Yeah, I just think that's a bit of a bummer. You were hoping to get a little bit more than just that first-round pick out of it, so.
I would tend to agree with that.
Yeah, Ricky Rubio coming off that torn ACL. So Pacers in-house free agents again. Jalen Smith, Lance Stevenson, TJ Warren. Ricky Rubio was one of them. So those three still on the open market. All right, we'll do one final time here. Kevin Aquari at 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
Hey, JMV, we all want the best for our kids, and being sure that they have a reliable source of financial information is a top way to help them gain independence as adults. Farm Credit Union's Young Leaders Council is a fun way to teach students financial basics to help them succeed in college and beyond. Our Young Leaders Council is for high school and college students looking to connect with each other and with an expert source for financial education. Learn more today and sign up right now. That's forumcu.com. Again, forumcu.com today.
Basements get a bad rap, probably because so many of them are wet, leaky, and musty. Thanks to screenwriters, crawl spaces aren't very popular either. Michaelis is putting an end to the horror show.
Their time-tested waterproofing systems eliminate and prevent water issues. Damp and moldy becomes clean and healthy. And their French drains, vapor barriers, and encapsulation techniques turn crawl spaces into a Disney set. Yeah, okay, that probably went a bit far. But with over 35 years' experience, they have a lot of homeowners enjoying their basements again. Think Michaelis. And think how nice it would be to get rid of foundation cracks, basement leaks, damp smells, and all the nightmares that come with them. Water, storms, fire, and foundations. Life happens. Michaelis happens to help you through it. Call 844-FIX-INDY. Make it Michaelis.
Join Mark Petrick Seminars and stop smoking now without cravings, irritability, weight gain, or your money back. Only $49.99 guaranteed. Also, let Mark Petrick Hypnosis destroy unwanted food cravings and lose the weight. Seminars Thursday, July 28th at the Hampton Inn & Suites in Fishers. Weight loss seminar 5:30 to 7:30 p.m. Stop smoking seminar 8 to 10 p.m. And Saturday, July 30th at the La Quinta Inn & Suites South in Indianapolis. Weight loss seminar 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Stop smoking seminar 2 to 4 p.m. Registration begins 30 minutes before seminar.
Soccer Saturday featuring Indy 11. If this is your football, this is your show. Saturday at 9 on The Fan. It's Kevin and Querry on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
Did you ever see Tom Petty in concert, Kevin?
I did not, no.
Mark?
No, would have loved to, though.
Probably a very popular artist being played here over the next 4 or 5 days.
Great performer, for sure. I saw him in Toronto not long before he passed, because it was during an IndyCar weekend, so it was in June. And I think he passed in, like, October, maybe? So I was, and that was the only time I'd ever seen him. So,
and where was that? Sorry,
Toronto.
Toronto.
Good show, I assume.
Yeah, it was good.
Did you see our friend Stephen Holder announce his departure from The Athletic yesterday?
I did, and I don't want to be. Stephen will be staying in the area, covering teams, but I don't know yet that it's been released that he is. He has the right, obviously, to say where that's where
he's
going.
I think
he
said yesterday he's going to let his bosses announce that, but I don't think he's going to be going too far. I did want to mention something that not this coming Monday, July 4th, the next Monday, July 11th, we're going to have Zach Kiefer in studio with us. He has done an Andrew Luck narrative podcast series, I believe is what he is called. That will be up on The Athletic.
With Andrew Luck?
He talked to Andrew Luck off the record, though, so Andrew will not be on the podcast, but David Shaw, Chuck Pagano, some Luck teammates, some former Colts, basically kind of looking back on his career and just the suddenness and shock of the retirement. For some Colts fans, they'd probably rather have their ears bleed than listen to something like that. But I think it'll be a fun listen. You know, I think clearly there's a ton of mystery around that, and looking forward to hearing a little bit of Zach's interaction with Andrew Luck, who, by all accounts, still calls Indiana and Indianapolis home.
I think the thing that we get lost with, Kevin, is that we assume that because we have a passion for sports, that means that all who are playing sports share the same passion. And there are some that are playing sports because they have an incredible athleticism or physical gift about themselves that facilitate for them a lifestyle and a life. And did Andrew Luck love football? Sure, I believe he did. But I also think that Andrew Luck, because we think that somebody should eat, breathe, sleep, and consume football all the time, he had natural gifts about him, including his intellect, that gave him interests elsewhere. And I think it's entirely possible that from the very beginning he just set out and said, you know what, once I get to a certain financial spot, when I have the ability to then travel the world and read books and see things that I want to see up close, that's what I'm going to do. And that's what happened, right?
You know, it takes an incredible amount of sacrifice to reach that peak level of stardom, you know, greatness.
And burnout's real, right?
Peyton Manning, Tom Brady, whatever you want to call it. And I just think Luck got to a point where he was unwilling to make those sacrifices. And that's pretty much what it was for him. Tony East points out this on Twitter, Jake. Cavs agreed to a deal with ex-Pacer guard Ricky Rubio. Again, 3 years, $18 million. He says Cleveland and Indiana could make it a sign-and trade with Dylan Windler, speaking of Perry Meridian.
Yep.
Or Chetty Osman, who, boy, there was one game last year against the Pacers where Chetty Osman looked like LeBron.
Dylan Windler just has not really gotten any reps in Cleveland, right?
Yeah, a little banged up, I think, as well. And he says if Cleveland wants to keep its mid-level exception, but no incentive for the Cavaliers to do that without a strong mid-level exception option. Notably, this deal fits within the taxpayer mid-level exception, so the Cavs won't get hard cap for the signing, blah, 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 blah. So we'll have to see just kind of the final details on that if anything comes in return.
Now, the Pacers need Cleveland to be slightly improved, right?
Oh, yeah, I saw someone else noted that on Twitter. Like, this is a good thing because it clearly means Cleveland, again, is trying to win, and you want Cleveland to be in the playoffs so you get their first-round pick. So, yeah, that is a good point.
You don't want them to be great, but you want them to be good enough to get in the playoffs, right?
No. And, you know, we mentioned Colin Sexton earlier in the week, Jake. You know, that rumor was out there. Vegas had the Pacers is pretty high up. Again, you just don't have room. Tyrese Haliburton is your guard and is your point guard. And he had an early morning this morning with Ronald Nored. So if you guys missed that interview, Ronald Nored, that'll be up on the podcast later today.
Did you guys see the Zion news?
Extension?
5 years, $231 million. It's like right around what Ja Morant just got. Does that surprise you?
Yeah.
Is it with New Orleans?
Yeah.
I guess a little bit of New Orleans is kind of backed into a corner of like what else can they do? Wasn't he like dunking and everything late last year, and it was kind of odd he wasn't playing?
He actually got more than Ja. Ja got 5 years, 193. He got 5 years, 231.
No, I thought Ja got, hold on. Ja Morant got 4 year, 226, right?
Okay, then one up. Then ESPN is wrong then.
That's what I read this morning. Maybe that's been it.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, 5 year deal on top of his original extension, so 231. You're correct.
I mean,
so identical deals. Ja Morant and Zion, who you taking?
Oh, Ja.
Yeah, without question.
Yeah, 10 days out of 10, yeah.
Yeah, that's wild.
I mean, Zion Williamson's obviously an unbelievable, like he's, Zion Williamson is like, I mean, this is a really bad comparison, but you have to pay him just because you know the potential's there, right? It's a huge risk, though.
You've made such an investment into him, you almost have to.
Huge risk.
Kind of ride it out. All right, I will be out next week. Going to be up at my in-laws' lake house.
Adults are leaving the room, Mark.
And it will be Mark and it will be Jake.
What are we doing on Monday, Mark?
Ooh, boy.
Well, nothing Monday.
Yeah, nothing
or
Monday.
Tuesday, yeah.
A lot of impressions there.
Mike DeCourcy coming on Tuesday. I know.
Oh, he'll be thrilled with that.
He's very excited.
Now, he's speaking a normal voice, or will you guys force him to
People will think that he's being joined by Paul Feinbaum.
I'll shoot him a text and say, what impressions can you do? And he'll probably be like, you know what, Tuesday, I can't make it.
Now, Jake, you aren't New York bound. You're New York bound next weekend?
Next weekend, yeah. I mean, I'll be here through Friday, but I'm leaving. As a matter of fact, 1 week from today, I'm going out with my friend Dan Wakefield, and we are going for part of the documentary about Dan to retrace where he and James Baldwin spent time in the village. So that'll
That's
be
awesome.
Fun. It'd be very cool.
And Mid-Ohio again this Sunday. Everybody have a safe 4th of July. Enjoy time with family and friends. Safe travels wherever you're going, and certainly safe time. And everybody have a great weekend. We will talk to you on, I will talk to you a week from Monday.
We will on Tuesday.
On Tuesday.